Most of you aren't just listening right now. You're driving, cleaning, and even exercising. But what if you could be saving money by switching to Progressive? Drivers who save by switching save nearly $700 on average, and auto customers qualify for an average of 7 discounts. Multitask right now. Quote today at Progressive.com. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. National average 12-month savings of $698 by new customers surveyed who saved with Progressive between June 2021 and May 2022. Potential savings will vary. Discounts not available in all states and situations.
Have you or a loved one been injured in an accident? Are you struggling to recover fair compensation? Look no further. At Phillips Law Firm, the experienced personal injury attorneys will fight for your rights and get you the justice and compensation you deserve. They handle a wide range of cases, including car accidents, slip and falls, medical malpractice, and workplace injuries. Justice is a phone call away, so don't wait. Call today for a free case review. Call 1-800-JUSTICE or visit justiceforyou.com.
Hey, it's Mike Hawk. Join me every Thursday at 1 p.m. exclusively on the Odyssey app as we go live with Odyssey. Join in on the action as we cover interesting facts, top 10 lists, and some fun new games. Follow the Men's Room page on the Odyssey app and join in all the fun Thursday afternoons at 1.
Unfortunately, what you're about to hear is real. The members of this radio program are simply not that bright, or what some people would call educated. They are merely stupid. They're not trying to offend anyone on purpose, and all have played doctors on TV. You have been warned and are cordially invited to join the party. This is the Men's Room.
Forget it, man, and get with the countdown. Get with the countdown. Shake this square world and blast off for Kicksville. The trippers, the grasshoppers, the hip ones, all gathered in secrecy and flying high as a kite.
This is the Men's Room with Miles and Thrill. You know what they say, shake your radio more than 3 times, and you're playing with it. You're listening to the Men's Room.
And away we go. Welcome to season 18, episode number 3,853. Along with Steve the Thrill Hill, the Ted Smith, and Mike Hawk. Montgomery! And you are in the Men's Room. What's up today? It is a random question, Your guess is as good as mine. Categories: tasty meats and bed bugs. We will play Profile This, plus headlines, a Men's Room shout of the day, fun with listener emails, and everyone's favorite, TV Time with Ted.
Clack, clack.
Drinking and drag. All right, here we go. Daytona Beach, Florida man hears a knock at the door, opens it, and an alligator jumps up and bites his leg. Meanwhile, a Massachusetts town is looking to open a store where you can buy weed and a lamp dance from Meg. Unruly passenger refuses to sit down, ignores crew instructions, and pees on a man in seat 15G. A wedding venue owner waves a gun at couple's reception for all to see. And a drunk guy steals a fire truck, crashes it, and then sets a house on fire in the fire truck. That is all coming on today's very special episode of The Men's Room.
And now, here's the question.
Hola, bitches. Good day to you and yours. All right, sometimes you just have to accept that you have too much of something, right? So if you're a collector of something, well, you can justify it just by pointing out that, well, you're a collector. See, that's how I condone the number of decks of cards and pieces of vinyl that I have all over the house. But something that I do not collect, Funko bobbleheads. And apparently, you don't either. Paraphrasing a statement from the company, their inventory vastly outweighs demand, and they're going to destroy $30 million worth of inventory. And in case you're wondering, I don't know how this works, but they said it's cheaper for them to destroy it than it is for them to try to sell it. So in a nutshell, no one is buying them, and they have too many. Now, to be fair, I'd rather have too many Funkos than, say, oh, I don't know, alligators. Too many alligators, very much a Florida problem, as we were reminded basically every week, and this past weekend, no exception. A man heard something at his front door, opened said door, and was promptly attacked by a 7-foot alligator on his porch. It didn't kill him, but it got a nice mouthful of upper thigh. Now, if this guy's like the average American, then I'm sure his upper thigh looked fat, juicy, and delicious. Because apparently right now, 38% of the world's population is overweight. And estimates are that by 2035, that number will be well over 50%. So are you overweight if almost more than half of people are overweight, or are you just normal? I don't know. But anyway, we're getting to the point where everyone's just going to look at the waitress and say, get me a bucket. Now, these are just some of the stories we've come across. Stories that left us with many questions. Questions we'd like to ask you in the form of our random question. And this is how it works. You call us. We will ask you a question at complete random. And after you share your story, we will share with you the news story that inspired said question.
Be part of the big show on the random question. Call 206-803-ROCK. Like the Men's Room on Facebook. Follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Men's Room Live. And send those emails to themensroom@KISW.com.
Walk the dogs, school drop-off, meetings from 10 to 3, take kids to soccer, then no time left for a jog.
When everyone else is relying on you, it's easy to put your needs last. BetterHelp connects you with a licensed therapist online, so you can show up for yourself the way you do for others. Visit betterhelp.com/positive to get 10% off your first month. That's betterhelp.com/positive.
What you watch depends on what kind of mood you're in. Sometimes you're craving comedies like Friends or South Park, and sometimes you're more into dramas like HBO's Succession and House of the Dragon. There's also cooking shows like Chopped and Beat Bobby Flay, and even movies like The Lord of the Rings and Shazam! Fury of the Gods. Well, Max is the streaming destination that has the best of entertainment for whatever mood you're in anytime. And plans start at as little as $9.99 a month. Max, the one to watch. Subscription required. Visit max.com.
You diet, you work out, and still there's that one stubborn spot. Hey, it's Jason. I just went after my stubborn fat by doing Cool Sculpting at Terrine Dermatology, Minnesota's top Cool Sculpting provider. Dr. Terrine is my dermatologist. We froze my fat, and those fat cells are gone for good. FDA approved. No pain, no downtime. Ranked top doctor 8 years in a row. Trust the experts at Terrine Dermatology. Call today, 651-633-6883, and say goodbye to stubborn fat.
If you're a contractor, it's now easier for you to do business with the Department of Labor and Industries. Go to lni.wa.gov/skip-the-line and make an appointment with us ahead of time. No waiting around, no wasted time away from your job site. You get in, get out, and get on your way. Easy. So contractors, just go to lni.wa.gov/skip-the-line to make an appointment and get back to doing what you do best.
Debauchery rolls on. You're listening to The Men's Room with Miles and Thrill. 99.9 KISW.
Oh, but y'all's away we go. Welcome to Season 18, Episode number 3,853. What a large and in charge program we have for you today. Guaranteed future repeat on this lovely Monday. The exciting return of your guests is as good as mine. We've got a couple categories here for you today. Every year, Orkin puts out the list of the most bed bug infested cities.
Yeah.
Here in the United States. The good news is Seattle, Washington is not in the top 10.
All we care about.
But many places that you might have visited, go to with some regularity, they all appear to be the top 10 cities with the most bed bugs. And then our other category today on your guess is as good as mine. We have the top 10 tastiest meats. You like meats? Ooh, okay. This covers everything from poultry to four-legged meat to the fish and crustaceans of the ocean.
Excellent, excellent.
Yeah, so it's going to cover all the bases there as far as your top 10 meats, obviously. I don't know a lot of people out there who's ever said, boy, I hate shrimp.
Not a lot of, you might some have people a shrimp allergy.
That's correct. Right. A lot of people say they would love to eat shrimp, but they can't do that. But it's all because of the allergies. What else do we have for you today? Oh, yes, more Men's Room every Monday through Friday here at 6 as we head on over to the Odyssey app exclusively for the Men's Room Happy Hour. That is on the Men's Room Happy Hour channel. So when you download the Odyssey app, do that. It is absolutely free. And be sure to sign in. Every time you listen to KISW, the Men's Room, BJ and Migs, Ryan and Taryn, and every other show that we bring you, every single hour that you listen, you have a chance to win tickets to a different show. This week, the show is KISS on their farewell tour at the Climate Pledge Arena. And I know what you're saying. I saw KISS on their farewell tour at the Tacoma Dome. Yes, Ted.
I saw them on their farewell tour, I want to say, when it was the Key Arena.
There you go.
Would you like to do it again? This is farewell to that was farewell Key Arena. Now it's farewell Climate Pledge. Because that's Paul Stanley's way.
Were you here last time when it was Key Arena? When I was climbing plant, we were forgetting about you people in Puyallup.
Now, KISS doesn't say that they're never going to do some one-offs, some festivals, maybe do a residency down in Las Vegas, but they are seemingly intent on being this, being the very last tour that they've done or will do around the world.
Touring kicks your ass.
Yeah.
You weigh 40 pounds of gear. You're in your 70s. I understand.
Mm-hmm. Well, I follow Gene and Paul on Twitter. And they're always playing shows someplace.
Sure.
And it just seems like even through the pandemic, they were doing something.
Mm-hmm.
Through COVID and everything else. But they have been on the road for a long time. They culminate the tour in New York City, which is where they're from.
Correct.
Show before that is Baltimore, but we get them in November, I believe.
Is it November?
I believe it's November. And I believe it's also on a Monday night.
Oh, God damn it. That's
Monday
right.
Monday night. I'm just like, and it's not, here's the old man.
Hope you don't like football.
Here's the old guy and me. Yeah, hope you're not hungover. I mean, Monday night, crying. Yeah, man. I know you're
thinking, assuming it's
just... Jeez, Miles, how old are you? Old enough to just go, I'll go, but it's a Monday night.
No, look, I'm with you.
Yeah.
Outside of Monday Night Football, it's not like people are really geared up to go out on Monday night.
No.
Right.
But I feel like in Seattle, we get a lot of those shows because tours either start or finish here.
Correct. Or close to it. Yeah, yeah. Absolutely. As a matter of fact...
You're going to go to this farewell tour to say you saw them say farewell twice?
You know what? When I saw them last time in person, I gave them a personal... Farewell.
I'm out. That's all I needed.
Except you meant it.
Yeah. Now, I saw Lionel.
I try to stick to my word.
I saw Lionel Richie a few years back in Vegas, but he's coming to town. I saw that announcement today. Another Climate Pledge Arena show. It is Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Mm-hmm.
And Lionel Richie. And, of course, once again, the second show in 2 weeks that they made an announcement for a Climate Pledge where I'm kind of geeked up in a way. And I look at the date today, and it's a Monday night again.
Come on.
It's another Monday night. I'm like, you got to be kidding me, man. Monday. But fortunately, I will say this about it. KISS will be one of those bands that, not that they're not, they're in their 70s, right?
Right.
But they'll still come on later on in the evenings. Lionel Richie, Earth, Wind, and Fire, they're like, man, we got to eat dinner, man. We're going to like 6.
Right.
I saw Lionel Richie.
Do you remember?
That's the thing about
that
Vegas
the
shows.
The diner closes at 8.
If it says 5:45, the show starts at 5:45. Get
it's
your ass
It's also
in
just
there.
A different mindset.
Right, the vibe
feels
a lot different.
Monday night, you want to go see Lionel Richie? You'd be like, hell yeah.
It's Monday.
I don't feel like I need, like, KISS. It's like, KISS, we got a party.
Yeah, exactly. Right.
Yeah, we'll have a couple beers. Go watch Lionel Richie.
So keep in mind, the way you do this when you download the Odyssey app is all you need to do is sign in. That way they can keep track of who's listening. And every single hour that you listen, you have another chance to win those tickets.
Mm-hmm.
So that's available for you exclusively on the Odyssey app. And, of course, we'll see you for the Men's Room Happy Hour coming up at 6 for more Men's Room. And we'll give some props for what seemed like a weekend that just flew by pretty quickly. And today is the day, of course, that we do our random question, 206-803-ROUND.
Random.
Hello,
random,
Jacob. Random, welcome to the Men's Room. Random.
Hola.
Jacob, welcome to the program. And a random question. Let's go with this one, man. What did you accidentally leave behind or forget to grab? Maybe just left it someplace. I do that with my favorite hats a lot, sunglasses a lot, things that I actually need.
You seen the latest commercial?
My phone.
The woman
iPad.
Astronaut. She comes back to Earth. She's been on the moon. She walks out to her vehicle, realizes she doesn't have her keys, so she does one of those, And they show her key fob sitting on the surface of the moon.
Really?
But with new smartphone technology, so you can still get in your car.
Here's the deal. It'll be cheaper to fly to the moon and get it than to pay for a replacement.
Yeah, no kidding.
So what did you accidentally leave behind or forget to grab?
You know, this weekend was Emerald City, and every time I end up buying a poster tube for a poster I buy at the con. But every time the next day when I've emptied the tube when I got home, it just disappears because I set it down somewhere.
Wait a minute. So you pulled the poster out of the tube earlier, forgot that you didn't put it back in, and then when you open it the next day, the poster's gone.
No. I get home, poster's out on a table somewhere, take the tube back thinking I'm going to buy more stuff. Set it down somewhere, it's gone.
Ah, I see. Okay.
All right. Fair enough.
What day were you at the con? I was there with 7 children on Saturday.
I was there all 4. It was wonderful.
Oh, good.
All 4. I liked it.
Well, they did a decent job. I will say, I've never had this experience before, but a stormtrooper dressed in the full, like, officially recognized stuff had to pee. And it is interesting to watch them
get out of their gear.
Well, the guy still had the helmet on, too. So he just kind of, because I'm kind of looking over at him, because I can tell, like, he's got to pee. But he still has the helmet on. You just kind of like, I just got to pee, but I got to get the stuff off, man. And then he peed with the helmet on, which I thought was a great touch.
Why not? If you can see
there's something about that. I'm like, I'm peeing next to a stormtrooper.
Yeah,
I will be. Goddamn. Mm. No, I'm really good at leaving important things. I'm very good at leaving credit cards at bars, then calling them the next day when they open to make sure it's there, and then go back and get that. I've left phones places. I've left my iPad on planes many times. I've left my iPad, as you know, Mike, because you went and got it for me at the Marriott in the Federal Way when I stayed down there for painting the grass. Like that damn thing right on my bed or on the counter, wherever the hell I did. I have no idea. It seems like if it's expensive and it's technology-based, that's what I will lose.
I'm pretty good about remembering that stuff. To his point at Comic-Con, at one point, mostly there were five kids under my watch. At one point, there were seven. So I'm with this guy, Jim, and I just said, man, because there's so many freaking people there, I said, look for my daughter's yellow wig. That's where I could figure out where they were. And I said, look, we're going to do a head count, all right? So just remember, there's seven kids. He's like, I know. So I said, all we need to do is return with seven kids to make sure we didn't forget any. Now, the caveat on my end is, I don't even care if it's the same seven. Just as long as we have seven, right? We did a head count. Maybe five of them are different. Not my problem. Good news is, didn't lose any of them.
Right.
Which is amazing.
I'm usually
that place.
Pretty good about my phone. But then, Labor Day weekend, after the last night of painting in the grass, I was getting a ride home from Taryn Daly and her husband Brad, left my phone in their car, and they brought it back. And then the following weekend, I left my phone at Thrill's house.
Oh, so no, that's right. That's
good
right.
About it, but two weekends in a row, I did it.
Right. The one that freaked me out the most, and this goes back a ways, but I had gotten in a car wreck, and my wife and I at the time, we didn't have a whole lot of money, but I got a settlement from going to physical therapy for $5,000.
All right.
This was more money than we'd ever seen in our lives. We paid off like $1,000 on a credit card, and the next thing we did was we immediately booked a trip to Jamaica.
All right.
So we have a flight on Air Jamaica out of BWI Airport to Baltimore Washington International Airport. We are packed. We are fired up. This is going to be our first real vacation. This is going to be exciting. I'm going to smoke weed. We're going to go see reggae concerts. This is going to be fantastic. We get to the airport. I've parked in the satellite parking.
Mm-hmm.
So we did not park at BWI. We parked at one of the independent lots, which is a little bit farther off. It offers a shuttle because they have a better deal for staying for the week. Whatever the deal was, we did our homework there to save a little cash. I pull into there. We get into the airport. This is the international terminal, which is a little bit different from the regular terminal. Blah, 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 blah. Get up to the counter. Don't have my ticket.
You didn't have your ticket.
Did not bring either ticket. Now, in this case,
Was it in the car? At least you left it at home.
I left it at home. And for whatever reason, because I guess it was international travel, I did have my passport on me. I had my ID on me, but I needed to have my hard ticket.
Yeah.
That was the policy at the time. So we're there a couple hours early. I fly back to the parking lot. I fly back home. I fly back to the airport. Get on the plane. The wife is already on the plane. She was going to go to Jamaica, whether I made it or not, because she figured out a way to talk the flight of people.
I was going
to
say, how did they let her
on? In between the time that she went through all the crap as far as the TSA goes. She talked her way into the terminal, onto the flight. I hadn't even got back to the airport yet. This is before cell phones.
Right, right.
So when I went to the counter, they said, yes, your wife is already through.
Did you ask how? Because you told me exactly that we need a ticket.
At this point in time, time's ticket. I need to hurry. You know what I mean? Like, I need to go. My bag still hasn't made it to the plane yet. They're holding that damn thing for me to get back there. Like, her bag is mysteriously on the plane.
Of course.
I'm just like, who did you flirt with? What really went down here? But, man, I was freaked the hell out. Now, this one involves By the way,
I don't know if this woman forgot her passport. Just the first time I went to Mexico, and this is why I always say, listen, when it comes to certain things, there are certain things where you take your friend's advice, right? Maybe you're having a relationship problem, or what should I wear? Where should I take my wife for Valentine's Day? Do not take their advice with legal stuff unless your friend is actually a lawyer. Mm-hmm. So all I hear is this bit of conversation as we're boarding the plane. This woman had her, think of driver's license. But she has purchased her ticket. She has her ticket miles. She remembered that part. But she didn't have her passport. So I don't remember what airline we're on. But she's arguing and trying to haggle with the gate agent. And I just hear her say, but my friends told me I don't need my passport to go to Mexico. And I just remember thinking,
pardon?
Does your friend work at the embassy? Is your friend a lawyer? Or is your friend, like most friends, just an average person who heard something somewhere and regurgitated to you? As a fact, this woman was old enough to know better. You know, I'm looking at her, she's probably 50 years old. I'm like, you still trust your friends on legal international travel advice? Are you stupid? So the gate agent, I just hear her say, ma'am, I can let you get on the flight. It's not our problem. What I'm trying to do is save you the trouble of the Mexican authorities putting your ass back on the flight and sending you right back here to get your passport, dummy.
Yeah, I mean, look.
Like, you can leave the country. U.S. doesn't care. It's when you get to another country. They're like, yeah, you need your passport, dummy.
Look, my mom would kill me for saying this on the radio, but we were taking a family trip, and she had rented a car.
All right.
When we get there, she doesn't have her license. And she, right, and she's like, well, I've rented a car here before. And the guy's just like, yeah, I need to see a driver's license. Right. Like,
how do you not have this on you? Right. You're traveling.
That's a very good question. I mean, it's a super good
especially
question.
Especially if you're picking up a rental car. In particular.
Or checking into a hotel.
Right.
Or
I mean, it was a nightmare. We had to call my aunt to come over and, like, show a license.
Raise my ass, what did you accidentally leave behind or forget to grab? Steve, you and I have been to this location. I don't know if, Mike, if you have or not. But, again, this happened on the couple's honeymoon. This is when I was in Maui as well. I was in Maui.
Oh, Maui. Yeah.
For my honeymoon. There's a little half moon crescent island. They do a lot of snorkeling trips out there. And they take you on a catamaran. They give you drinks. They put you in the water for a couple of hours. You see some crap. Either they move to a different location so you can see some whales, and they bring you back
in. We debated doing that, but I'm like, I'm not trying to get in the water.
So Elizabeth Webster and Alexander Burkle, they set out from Maui on a snorkeling trip during their honeymoon. And they were probably expecting a bit of an adventure, but not to be left behind at sea. That's what the California couple says happened. Now they're suing the tour company Sail Maui for $5 million over the incident. According to the USA Today, they say that at the first stop, the boat planned to stay anchored for an hour while guests snorkeled. Well, Webster and Burkle started swimming back to the boat in the allotted time frame, but the water was too choppy for them to make pretty good progress. It can be really rough out there, even for people that are experienced in the ocean. Lawsuit accuses crew members of incorrectly carrying out the head count and insisted the couple were on board, despite other passengers alerting crew to the fact that they were missing.
Oh,
so they did a head count. So basically, they just lied.
Yes. After the boat moved on to the next location on the snorkeling tour, the couple managed to make it to the nearest shore, about a mile away, in distress and injured by coral from shallow reefs in the area, and dehydrated, according to their lawsuit. They used the phone of someone who came to their aid to call for the tour company, which did not realize they were missing and sent a ferry back to pick them up. Coast Guard had already investigated the incident and cited Sail Maui, which now makes, they say, vocal contact with each of its passengers before leaving a location.
What difference
just
does that
to make
though?
Sure. I just can't imagine.
But you do the head count or do a vocal count if you say, no. Basically, right. The company said, sure, we counted them, which either you do not know how to count or you knew goddamn well you're missing two. So even vocal contact.
Right. The water is rough there.
Happened to Gillian. It's right in the song.
The boat actually shields a lot of the incoming current.
Yeah.
As far as that little island goes, it kind of breaks everything on the backside of it. There's a reason that people just don't go out there and snorkel on their own. It's so far off the coast, you need to take a tour boat
right. Just
to get out to that location. You couldn't take a kayak out or anything like that. I mean, you're not going to drop anchor out there. The water's incredibly deep, and
sure,
it's a long way to go. So there's a reason that this tour company makes money exclusively off taking people to this location, because it's too far to swim. But either way.
But apparently it's not, because they made it.
Exactly.
Damn.
More of the Random Question coming up, 206-803-ROCK.
Love the skin you're in. With Hand and Stone Massage and Facial Spa's facial services, enjoy the tranquility and deep relaxation while giving your skin a rejuvenating glow. All facials are tailored to your individual needs, using the highest quality ingredients, designed to give you healthy, radiant, and younger-looking skin. Visit any one of their 8 Seattle Hand and Stone Massage and Facial Spa locations or book online at handandstone.com. Restrictions apply. See spa for details. T-Mobile's network can help keep you connected to all your favorite podcasts when you're out and about. Whether you're an early bird looking to dive into a daily news podcast or a night owl who wants to catch up on the latest reality TV drama, T-Mobile will keep you connected on their strong and reliable network. T-Mobile covers more highway miles with 5G than anyone. So if you need great coverage, especially when you're on the go, check out T-Mobile. Find out more at T-Mobile.com/CY. That's SEEWHY.
Nobody said adulting would be easy. Between work, family, chores, and activities, life can get real messy real fast. Good thing there's Simple Green All-Purpose Cleaner. Simple Green tackles even the toughest cleanup jobs in every room of your house. Simple Green has been a trusted cleaning brand for nearly 50 years, and it's now available in both lemon and lavender scents. So you get a cleaner that not only works hard, but leaves your home smelling fresh. Even better, Simple Green All-Purpose Cleaner is U.S. EPA Safer Choice certified for use around people, pets, and plants. Stronger, safer, fresher. That's the cleaning experience we all want, right? When life gets messy, Simple Green gets it clean. This stuff literally removes dirt, grease, and stains from any washable surface in your home.
Visit simplegreen.com today to view their complete product lineup and discover where to buy in your area.
If you're a contractor, it's now easier for you to do business with the Department of Labor and Industries. Go to lni.wa.gov/skip the line and make an appointment with us ahead of time. No waiting around. No waste of time away from your job site. You get in, get out, and get on your way. Easy. So contractors, just go to lni.wa.gov/skip the line to make an appointment and get back to doing what you do best.
Shenanigans continue. This is the Men's Room with Miles and Thrill.
I had a question, 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, TC. Welcome to the Men's Room.
TC, welcome to the program. Random question, Let's go this one. TC, how did you meet someone that you dated? Of all the people you went out with in your life, what was one of the more interesting ways you met someone?
Quick one on the what was left behind before. Took my parents and my aunt out to the airport to go to Greece for my sister's wedding. They all got out and I left. And I turned around and looked in the back seat and there's the camera bag. I don't know how many laws I broke to get turned around, but I slid the car up to the United Terminal, go running in, past the desk, back through the back into their gate. And today I would have been shot.
Yeah,
a long time. What a person I met, interestingly, when I had my business, one of the very, very few days that I went home from work because I was sick, I met a future girlfriend at Metro Parking Ride.
Yeah, that's okay. What the good ones always are. How did you strike up conversation? Just were you waiting for the same bus kind of thing or what?
Oh, no. I was sitting at the other end, just keep away from her so she wouldn't get sick. She's one that her parents got really drunk and I had to do their Thanksgiving dinner for.
Okay. I remember that.
All right. Okay.
So why did she start talking to you if you're sick and you're sitting a good distance away?
Well, I asked her, she looked pretty cool. I asked her if I could buy, half a gram of weed off her and she came over and just gave it to me.
Okay. Okay. Well, you asked the right person then.
Damn.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
That's old school, half a gram.
That really is.
I know.
Mm-hmm.
Half a
was that a nickel bag?
Yeah, like half a gram.
Yes, I'll give you a bud. Raise your ass, how did you
it sounds more generous when he says half a gram.
I know. Okay. Yeah. Nothing.
That's not a lot. How did you meet someone that you dated? We go to Wisconsin where a bachelor hopes his unique approach to dating will help him find his future partner. Robert Siegfried, 43, says he's exhausted. All the other dating options, they're not working for me, said Match, Tinder, none of them were working.
It's their fault.
So he's turned to an electronic billboard along Milton Avenue in Janesville to find the love of his life. By calling the number he lists, he tells local honest women to leave him a message. He says, I like country music, the American flag for the USA. I'm a country boy at heart. And that's basically what he puts as he puts the photo up of himself on the billboard. Now, you might be shocked. So far, Siegfried says he hadn't had much success from the billboard.
You don't say.
Many people who do reach out to him, he said, are just not the person he's looking for. But he said, you'd be surprised at how many pictures I'm getting. The number one bachelor sign hopes it'll bring him the one that he loves because it says this is Wisconsin's number one most eligible bachelor on the billboard.
I don't think eligible is quite the right word. I think maybe available. Right. When you take out a billboard, you're available.
Sounds like he gave himself that own title.
He did.
Right.
He says, go big or go home. I mean, you don't get any bigger than this. I hope people take it seriously. I hope people really take it seriously. Don't be shy. If you're interested, just call me. I'm just looking for that special someone, he said. Online court records show that Siegfried has a restraining order put in place against him. He's had it for the last 4 years. So there's one person out there that he can't be around, which is probably the last person he dated.
Why?
That.
I mean,
he is available.
So yeah. There's a restraining order out against him?
Mm-hmm.
From someone against else. Them. It's been active for 4 years.
I mean,
which
look.
Means every year it keeps getting reinstated.
Yeah, I mean, that's not good, dude.
No, it's
once
not.
You take out a billboard looking, quote-unquote, for love, that's the ultimate red flag. I mean, and look, they have all those dating apps. If you can't find someone there, it's probably something to do with you. There are tens of millions of people on those dating apps. Ugly people get hooked up. Good-looking people. You know, I mean, it's almost a standard bear. We had a guy years ago when Match first kind of launched, became national, this guy TJ. Hey, man, look, he liked chicks. He had the right car. He had a cool job. Mm-hmm. All the stuff, right? So He goes on Match.com. And he, no one ever had the heart to tell him, right? He was a decent enough guy, but just like, yeah, man, I'm joining Match.com. Hey, good for you, whatever. About 2 weeks later, he's like, man, I had to call Match.com. We're like, why'd you have to call Match.com? He's like, oh, man, there's something wrong with the website. I'm like, what do you mean? He goes, well, I haven't gotten any hits. You know, like, no one's responded to me. So we all just kept quiet, and we're like, so wait, you called Match.com? He goes, yeah, there's got to be just something wrong. We said, but you posted your picture. Yeah. Gave your self-description. Uh-huh. And you haven't gotten any hits, TJ. Not one, man. It's been 2 weeks. That's why I called him. And no one had the heart to tell him, bro, look, this is a you thing. You know what I mean? Like, this is you. There's nothing wrong with Match.com. It works. Yes. It just doesn't work for you.
He asked out
also,
every...
you could put in, like, what you're looking for.
Okay.
Right? So I'm 42. But if I just put in there, you know, 25 to 30, you're not going to get a lot of hits.
No.
Sure. Right.
Also, he asked out every available woman in the building we worked for.
Oh, my God.
At the time. And like anything else, when you see someone new who gets hired or comes in or whatever, the first thing you're thinking of is like, I give TJ 3 days.
Before he's going to go up there.
Before he already starts working his magic.
And if you say
or
yes,
lack thereof,
he's going to be in love with you in a week.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to start a date this girl. I'm telling you, man. I'm
taking her to Ocean City for the weekend.
Like, no, you're not, man. You're horny, and she's giving you some ass. Please do not mistake these things. Hello, Michael. Welcome to the men's room.
Hey, boys. How you doing?
Hola.
Michael, welcome to the program. Random question.
So I bet the last guy who put out the billboard saying he's available, the fact he has a restraining order was like, what a shocker.
Yeah.
I mean, anyone, you know, think about any of us can put up a billboard if we're single and say, yeah, I'm looking for a lady. To me, and look, I don't know what ladies like, obviously, but I would just think that's a turnoff. How'd you meet?
Yeah.
I saw a billboard with his number.
Let's go with this one. Yeah. How did you find out that you either broke or were breaking the law? How did you find out you were breaking the law?
To be honest, gentlemen, I haven't broken the law without me knowing it.
Well, look, I mean, there's certain things, all right? So, jaywalking is illegal. I knew that jaywalking was frowned upon. I did not know it was an actual law because that seems so stupid to me for adults. And then moved to Seattle, walking across the street because there's no traffic. It's not like I'm impeding progress, but two cops are to meet him, and this guy's screaming his head off at me, and I don't know what he's yelling about. I can just tell that he's agitated. It's something I did, but in my mind, I've done nothing, so I'm very cordial. And I go, what is up, man? And he's like, you just crossed the street. I said, that is exactly why I was standing on the corner, bro. And he's like, but you're jaywalking. And I started laughing, and I said, honest to God, is that actually a law? He's like, yeah. And he was pissed about it.
Right.
But, I mean, they were like, you know, I could write you a ticket. Like, you can do whatever you want. I ain't paying a goddamn ticket because I walked across the street. And, by the way, in most states, I bet you've broken the law just having sex if you had sex in any position that is not missionary. You have all those archaic. Yeah.
Especially with weed. When weed became legalized, there was where you could smoke it and where you can't. And basically, if you weren't in your living room.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's basically legally the only place you're really allowed to smoke it. I mean, even if you're out on your porch, it's somewhat questionable if it quaffs over to the neighbor.
If the neighbor smiles, then they can
any of that stuff. So it's smoking within 25 feet of a door, of an entrance of someplace. If you're smoking cigarettes, that is also illegal as well.
I'd start talking. Because when that law first came in, they were a lot more trying to enforce that. And I was like, dude, I'm making a rough guess at what 25 feet is. Either you can start marking this S on sidewalks, but I'm like, do you even know? Because right now we're maybe 22 feet away, but as a cop, do you know that I am not 25 feet away? Because I can't tell. I'm trying to get away. I don't know where the 25-foot mark is. But, Michael, you said you've never broken a law that you weren't aware of. What are some of the laws you've broken knowing damn well you were breaking the law?
Running red lights, for instance. Or just being over the speed limit. And as far as figuring out distance, so the length of your total of your arm span is equal to your height. So in your case, Thrill, 25 feet would basically be
four arm spans.
Yeah.
I'm going to start doing that. People go, what are you doing? Hey, look, I'm making sure I'm 25 feet away.
But when you're downtown, it's almost impossible to be 25 feet away from the doorway.
Not only that, but I always do it in hoops. I always go 10 feet. So I know the free throw line. So I take the free throw line, which is about 10 feet, somewhere in there. Or is it longer than that? I can't remember. But whatever that is, that's kind of how I mark it. I
think
it's about 10 feet. I think it's the height of the basket.
I just kind of eye it. You know what I mean? It'd be about
might be 12
here.
Feet. I don't know.
Somewhere around this area. I'm
trying to think what a free throw is.
Right.
15.
15 feet. So
you've been cheating.
I've been shorting myself.
I think you're already off when you say, this is how I measure it. How long is that?
I don't know. Yeah. I just don't know how long it is. I'm like, all right, there's a free throw right there. There's another free throw. Surely I'm out of the way. Oh, the reason we asked, how did you find out you were breaking the law?
I'm not sure you know what a free throw is.
I'm not sure if I do either.
You got to get a Miles?
Yeah,
if there's
a
foul while you're shooting.
Yeah, I can take that. Deputies say Honduran nationalists may not have realized what they did was illegal. A pair of 20-year-olds in Nebraska, they face hefty fines and possible prison time after authorities say they hunted and killed a bald eagle. The wrinkle in the case is that both men are Honduran nationals who speak no English, and it's possible they had no idea the bird was federally protected. Sland County deputies investigating reports of a suspicious vehicle at the Wood Duck Recreation Area, and they encountered the two men who freely opened their truck and showed them the bird. Because the deputy spoke no Spanish, they used a translation app to communicate. The men first said they shot a vulture, though it's possible the app got that wrong. The men told deputies they intended to take it home and cook it and eat it, according to the sheriff. Instead, they're going to face a fine of $100,000 and up to a year in prison. State wildlife officials confiscated the eagle. The two men live in Norfolk, about 100 miles northwest of Omaha, Nebraska.
I like their style, though. I mean, the cops ask. And they're straight up like, yeah, it's in our trunk. Here it is. Mm-hmm. So, but you have no idea. But that's one of those things that always concerns me anytime you travel internationally. You know what I mean? There's just some things that might not be frowned on in the States, might be frowned on there. So you just don't know. Like, you hear about people that go to Dubai.
Right.
And in Dubai, I know they have the things about alcohol and drugs. Unless you're a millionaire, then it's plentiful. But just stuff like holding hands or kissing in public.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you go there with your wife, you hold hands. And now you have a problem, and you don't know what you've done. And they finally explain, hey, you cannot show affection, not publicly.
Right.
You cannot hold hands as you walk through a mall. Like, it's my wife. I think you can hold hands with your kids,
yeah.
But that's about it.
The one that stung me, I was 18 years old, 19 years old, and I'm driving to a concert in Pittsburgh, the equivalent of the White River Amphitheater. They have one up there as well. Outdoor concert, kind of out of the way, but... Basically, you had to get on a two-lane road off the interstate to get to this particular venue. So I'm driving there. I'm young. I'm working at a radio station. We sponsored the show. I've got concert tickets. We gave those away. I'm like, I'm going to go have a good time. Get on the two-lane road, and there's a cop on the side of the road.
All right.
Now, the cop is out of the car, and he's standing there with a gun. All right. Well, okay. I'm not speeding, so I go past him, but it's a two-lane road. So all the cars that are coming the other way, I start flashing on my lights.
Oh,
so that they know that there's a cop there. Little did I know that the cop that was gunning people, he had another cop down the road in the direction that I was going that was actually pulling the cars over. So that guy was stationary. He was never going to jump in his car.
Right, but he's going to radio and let you
know. He's going to radio down and go like, hey, man, that blue Pontiac, I just clocked it at 65 miles an hour or whatever the deal is and pull you over. I wasn't speeding. However, I was flicking the lights at all the cars that were coming the other direction. So immediately this guy jumps into his car when I see him up there and he sees what I'm doing. So I keep driving, man, pulls me over. And he's like, man, he's like, you are infringing on law enforcement or you're impeding police something rather or whatever. And I was like, I've always been taught. And
to
that if there's a cop and people are coming the other way, to flick your high beams so they have an idea, so they have warning, so they know that you're there.
And they slow down.
And he's like, dude, that's illegal. And I'm like, I honest to God, I did not know it was illegal. I was like, I won't do it anymore, but I did not know it was illegal. So he gave me a warning, and I'm like, just, you know, my heart's going a million miles an hour, because I'm like, I don't have $50.
Right.
Whatever the ticket is, I don't have $100. Like, I'm going to a free concert. Like, I've got Milwaukee's best light in my truck.
Right.
You know, like, I'm economical. I'm being as thin as I can. I put like $5 in my gas tank to be able to get most of the way there.
I didn't know that was illegal either. And then I was arguing. I said, okay, look, in a sense, I get it. But if the idea is you want to pull over speeders, not to make the money, of course, like everyone accuses people. No, this is for safety. Then is it bad? That I have to convince people to slow down.
It's BS.
Even if it's just because you're there. But if they're slowing down and you say it's about safety, then let us flash our high beam. Now, that said, we know goddamn well it's a cash grab. It has nothing to do with safety. That's BS, right? But that's always your argument. But same thing because, all right, Ted, you're going to rob a bank. I know you're going to rob a bank. Now, I call you on your cell phone and go, bro, I would not do this bank today. There's 20 cops across the street having coffee.
All right.
Do not target this bank. And then I find out that I called you to tell you to not commit a crime. Is that wrong? If you prevent a crime from happening, even if my reasons for preventing it aren't pure, right? doesn't matter. I prevented a bank from getting robbed, or I prevented people from getting shot. Even if my reasons aren't pure, it's the preference that we allow a crime to happen that we could prevent. Right? I mean, because that's the message you're sending. Like, so...
That, right.
Don't... You could tell people to slow down. They're not going to listen to me. If I flash my lights, they will slow down. I've had people that flash their lights and there was no cop. They just did it because they hate people at speed, right? But it works. Everyone slowed down, so our safety went up.
I mean, it's not on the cops,
it's the law, but that's a stupid-ass law.
I only knew it was illegal, too, because there was a road where I grew up that was pretty famous for, like, it was like a dip in it or something. Either way, these cops always sat up there and had speed traps during rush hour.
Sure.
But same thing. Me and my brother were cruising through. He flashed the lights, and I'll be damned. They had two more cops set up down the road to stop people from flashing lights.
Same thing.
Same exact
thing. But you didn't know either, right? Or did you?
I can't remember. I don't think we, honestly, no. Because it was like when he pulled us over, right? My brother was like, I didn't realize it was illegal. And then, of course, I think that turned into a whole conversation in the house. Like, why is that illegal?
Because just growing up, because we went on so many freaking road trips when I was a kid. But I remember you start picking up on a run age six, you know, because I'd alert my dad in case he didn't say, hey, man, I got his flash his lights. And our car would decelerate. And sure enough, you go by the cop at exactly 55 miles an hour. But if that's the case, all right. What about truckers? Anyone with a CB in their car?
Mm-hmm. Well, if you have a Waze app, it'll tell you, man. You put where you see officers.
I don't think they like the Waze app, though.
I don't know that it's illegal.
I don't know that it is either, but it's the same application.
But everyone with a CB would tell you, hey, man. I mean, they're on the radio. If you had a CB, my uncle, he had a CB in his car for a little while. And we didn't get into most of the trucker stuff, other than one time he almost got us killed. But most of the conversation was about where cops were. You know, they might shoot the S a little bit, but overwhelmingly, they're just letting you know, hey, man, there's an accident up there. Look out for this a-hole in the blue Mustang. Keeps cutting people off.
Right.
Here's where the cops are at mile marker so-and-so. Like, if in the end, everyone makes better decisions about their driving, just because, look.
Right, that's the point. People are slowing down. Isn't that what we're supposed to be doing?
Right.
Now, look. Mm-hmm. The bottom, and right, it's not individual officers. Like, the department's never going to come out and go, actually, we do have quotas and we need to make this money.
Right.
So if you're not going to say it, then it's like, also, you can't get mad at the Waze app or people flashing lights because it's like, people are slowing down. Isn't this about safety?
The girl I was going out with at the time, I'm like, hey, man, Steph, just get in the glove compartment, pull out my registration. I just did my insurance, which was a lot of money for me at the time. It was expensive. I'm like, I have my crap taken care of. I was not speeding back there. Like, I was going 55 miles an hour.
Were you stoned?
No. Okay. No, in a 55. I mean, literally, I was, because it's two-lane roads. I mean, it's fast speed limit for the availability of those roads. I was doing that. So when I rolled down the window, he's like, you know why I pulled you over? I'm like, actually, I have no idea. Like, but here's my stuff. He's like, are you going to the concert tonight? Because that was the road that goes. And that's why they were sitting on that road. We're going to the concert tonight. Make sure I wasn't inebriated. And he came back and told me what I did.
Well, the good news is a bunch of people are chiming in to say, look, flashing your lights, it's not illegal. It's actually protected speech. It's been ruled by many federal courts. Someone actually challenged a lawsuit flashing your lights to warn other drivers. The Supreme Court said it is not illegal.
Well, they did that after I got pulled over.
Yeah, right.
What, 1989? More of the random question coming up, 206-803-ROCK.
Odyssey celebrates Pride by amplifying the voices, music, and conversations of the LGBTQ+ community. Download the free Odyssey app and listen to podcasts celebrating and having conversations about the issues facing LGBTQ+ Americans, like It's Okay to Say Gay, Queer Intentions, and The Bald and the Beautiful with Trixie Mattel and Katia Zamo. To hear music by and for the LGBTQ+ community, plus podcasts and more, go to odyssey.com/pride or download the free Odyssey app. That's AUDACY.
Come on, men, put your backs into it.
Captain, you might consider talking to a specialist about your anxiety.
I can't do that without a referral from my doctor, and I marooned him on an island.
If you have a Pacific Source health plan, Captain, you're not required to have a referral.
Pacific Source health plans, you say? Excellent. I've done some of my best work in the Pacific.
No referrals required to see a specialist. Just another way Pacific Source health plans goes beyond what's required. Visit PacificSourceMembersFirst.com.
Dealing with an accident and injury claim can be overwhelming. Let Phillips Law Firm fight for you. We understand the pain and suffering, and we're here to guide you through. Call 1-800-JUSTICE today for a free case review, or visit justiceforyou.com and let Phillips Law Firm help you on the road to recovery.
Most of you listening right now are probably multitasking. Yep, while you're listening to this, you're probably also driving, cleaning, exercising, or maybe even grocery shopping. But if you're not in some kind of moving vehicle, there's something else you can be doing right now. Getting an auto quote from Progressive Insurance. It's easy, and you could save money by doing it right from your phone. Drivers who save by switching to Progressive save nearly $700 on average. And auto customers qualify for an average of 7 discounts. Discounts for having multiple vehicles on your policy, being a homeowner, and more. So just like your favorite podcast, Progressive will be with you 24/7, 365 days a year. So you're protected no matter what. Multitask right now. Quote your car insurance at progressive.com to join the over 29 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. National average 12-month savings of $698 by new customers surveyed who saved with Progressive between June 2021 and May 2022. Potential savings will vary. Discounts not available in all states and situations.
KISW. We return to the men's room with Miles and Thrill.
Check out KISW.com and the Rock Shop for the new SEA hoodie.
Woo. Oh, yeah. Show your support for our fine city here and this fine radio station.
It is a stylish hoodie. Wear it all year round. It's lightweight. It's got the Rock logo on the front and SEA embroidered in the back. It's a fine piece of apparel there. In the Rock Shop now at KISW.com. That is, if you don't want to buy our green beans t-shirt, I mean, that's up to you.
But if you buy one of our green bean t-shirts, do us a favor and gift it to us. I mean,
what's that one our way?
We're yet to get one. I'm
maybe
just
they're soft and nice, like the hockey-inspired KISW t-shirt.
I would not know.
I wouldn't know either. They sure are comfy shirts. And that sure is a comfy jacket. Steve, I know your wife probably likes it a lot.
Well, I have the hockey-inspired shirt.
I do have the hockey one, yes.
I'm wearing mine right now.
That one is comfortable. The hoodie, like I said, even when they handed it to us. My boy, it's a nice hoodie. So I laid it out, snapped two pictures of it front and back, sent it to my wife.
So you have memory.
Your new hoodie. Well, because it's just this. I won't feel like she stole it from me if I give it to her. Mm-hmm. Inevitably, she's going to wear it all the time. So I'm like, let me just go ahead and get it.
Well, I've got my daughters in town this week, so I know for the most part I'm going to hide all my hoodies when I get home tonight.
The only one I would not let her have is
she took my Willie Nelson hoodie.
See, like, no. I got my Black Label Society one. That's the one. She actually called me at work. Hey, where's the Black Label Society hoodie? I said, it is sitting on the back of my office chair. So I want to take the dog out. I said, one, you can wear one of your hoodies or one of my other plentiful collection of hoodies.
That's right.
This one I like. That's why I brought it with me. Hello, David. Welcome to the men's room.
Hello.
Hola.
David, welcome to the program. Random question. Let's go with this one. David, what would you say you have too much of or that you need to get rid of? What do you either have too much of or something you need to get rid of?
Time on my hands.
What's
time?
That?
He said time on his hands.
Time, yeah, I got too much time on my hands.
That's a Tommy Shaw song from Styx.
Too much time.
Too much time on my hands. What are you doing with all this time you have?
Being bored.
Okay. What would you like to be doing with this time? No hobbies, nothing like that?
I'd like to be actually surfing.
We did not understand a word you just said.
It sounds like somebody who's very busy over there for having no time on your hands.
Yeah, I'm in a building downstairs. So I've got to be surfing in Hawaii.
All right. I think a lot of people
would. So let me guess, you have more time on your hands than money.
Exactly. I got zero money.
Okay. That is
do
problem.
You have a job?
No. The state considers me disabled.
Does that mean you get a disability check?
No, actually, they just cut me off. So I don't get a check at all now.
What was your injury?
My injury was nothing. They said I was mental.
Oh, mental.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Gotcha. And is there any way that you can still go out and get a job, or are you just incapable of doing
it? Yeah, I can go out and get a job. It's just everybody wants a resume, and I haven't worked for like 10 years.
All right. Well,
I was homeless.
Okay. I think there'd be somebody out there, depending on your skill set, that would say, look, we understand what you were going through there, and there's a reason that you were put on disability for that amount of time. That makes perfect sense. That explains your resume having that gap in it.
Yep.
So just go a little bit before that and see what you can pull off, you know?
Oh, there's jobs out there.
I say, yeah, I'm almost guaranteeing you could find a job in a kitchen.
Guaranteed. Look, I worked in kitchens. You can get a job in a kitchen, man. Like, if you can just do the work, because everyone in the kitchen, and I mean this in the best way possible, and I know this to be true, there's something wrong with you.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there is. Everybody has, whether it's drugs, whether it's just mental, whether it's physical, whether it's just you have a bad temper, whether you're too, you name it, everybody's got a story. Certainly, a lot of felons Work in the kitchens.
Yeah.
Which, that's kind of a hard sell. But, man, when it comes to restaurants, like, okay, you're in jail for 15 years. You robbed three banks. Yeah. Can you make souffle? If you answer yes, they're like, welcome to the team.
Well, well, guys,
at Slither, we just say, can you crack an egg?
Right. I mean, it's, look, man.
Souffle. Like, we don't, you don't have to go that far.
Work the omelet station.
Yeah, but years ago, kidding. I hired a dude. So he came in for a job interview, and I'm in a position of being able to hire him. And his eyes were a little red, and I'm looking at this guy. I'm like, dude, are you stoned right now? And he kind of drops his eyes, and he's like, yeah, man, I apologize. I said, no, that is not a problem. It's a kitchen, dude. So being stoned is not the problem. Found out that he also was a weed dealer years before weed was legal. That's how he got the job. Quick side note.
Did he do an okay job of the job?
He did a fantastic job at the job, but I literally hired him because everyone in the kitchen buys weed all the time. If we have one guy that can reliably provide it to us, which he did, and he was smart, like, he knew when payday was. He kind of took pre-orders, and this guy would come in, always deliver the weed, and he'd work a shift with us. Now, at the, this was a Joy America Cafe.
All right.
So we had a big catering event once, and it was the reception for a wedding, but they were coming to our restaurant to eat the food. No problem. The nice thing about that is we don't have to open a restaurant regularly. We're just preparing their well-together menu, all right? So everybody got really, really high because everyone was a little stressed about this. So I took them over to this place called Federal Hill. We sat on the hill. Everyone smoked weed just to calm everyone's nerves. We go back to work. We go in that kitchen. It is dead silent. And you know this. When you get stoned and you start doing something, you are focused on your task at hand. And everyone's doing real excellent. Well, Bill, the guy that sold the weed, he got stoned with us. And he walks over and he goes, hey, man, I think I messed up. I'm like, what station do you work? I'm filleting all the salmon, right? You get fresh salmon in, we're filleting this for whatever. I go, okay, well, it can't be that bad. Typically, when you fillet, well, salmon, almost any fish, you cut off the head, okay?
Mm-hmm. You gut it, and you start with the tail.
But you kind of, right, and you run the knife basically along the spine. That way you cut it into equal halves. To this day, I don't know how he did this. The salmon was still whole. The head was still on. The only place there was still skin was the head of the fish. He had somehow cut all of the skin. So it is like
he skinned the salmon.
It's like this big pink corpse. And I'm like, on my best day with a really good knife, I don't know that I could do this.
He was zoned in.
So the only problem we had was once you cut the skin, certainly on salmon.
It's kind of hard to keep the fish together.
Yeah, because the meat's real tender, it falls apart. So we tried to save it. The whole thing fell apart. We ended up just doing, I would have called ceviche with it.
I'm
like, look, man, it's, we kept trying to fillet it, but there was no way to hold this salmon to fillet it, let everything break it apart. Jesus. But his cutting board looked disgusting. It was just, I'm like, dude, it's just a skinned fish, man.
I mean, he must have some good weed that he was that zoned in that he skinned a salmon.
But the whole thing, and at no point, until he was done and visually looked at it, I think something clicked in his head and said, that is not at all what this is supposed to look like. But I'm like, you actually pulled this off high, man.
It's and
like,
it would have been a pain.
If you tried that sober, you'd be real, real annoyed. Like, what, this is stupid.
What would you guys say you have too much of? Not that you need to get rid of it, but you have too much of it.
I know. I mean, look, I collect vinyl. I know. And my father just gave me a bunch of his, so I'm probably like 600 pieces. I had to buy a new shelf. My wife's cool with it because we dig the music. I like collecting decks of cards. I have stored most of them away, but that's probably about 400 or 500 of those.
And she's,
you need them? I know I don't need them. That's why I call myself a collector.
I would
say T-shirts.
I've got tons of CDs and no CD player. And you got koozies.
Yeah, but I don't think I have too many.
How many do you have? You have a whole drawer full of them, don't you?
Probably 30.
30?
Okay. I know, but
to a normal person, they'd be like, Ted, you have too many. Now, we understand. You collect them.
In my instance, when you're saying, what do you have too many of something you want to get rid of? It'd be T-shirts.
Okay. All right.
Right? Like, I don't want to get, like, you have CDs, but you can't play them.
Correct.
Like, the koozies get used. Even if it's just a soda water, like a regular soda water. Or
do you have the skinny ones for the skinny cans? Do they make a skinny koozie for like a White Claw?
Because I've seen like the bottle ones.
Or like a
standard
can. Like a Corona Premier can.
I don't know that, right? Or Michelob Ultra?
Yeah.
I don't know that I have one for those. But I usually just put the Ultra in a regular koozie.
Okay.
Okay.
Right. So
are you going to get rid of your CDs?
No. I'm going to.
The vinyl I listen to. Granted, the cards I don't really play. But the vinyl I at least listen to. I have what you need to listen to it. The CDs, I want to say my wife and I purged ours. She kept a few. You know, they mean something to her, whatever. But we took, you know, hundreds of CDs years ago and just got rid of them.
I haven't done that yet. I'm going to keep them until I get a little portable CD player that I can figure out a way to Bluetooth into my speaker. Like
they have them.
Yeah, I know. I just haven't bought one.
Don't you have vinyl as well?
I do. But I don't think I have too much of that. To me, it's like, I don't have enough.
No. What I'm saying is, I guess, like,
you could duplicate the same albums. right?
Oh, yeah. I've got them on CD, the same ones, probably a lot. Probably 25% to 50% that I do on vinyl.
Right, so that's the only reason I would ask, why bother keeping the CDs? Because you can...
I get rid of my duplicates for sure.
I mean, it's like me with the t-shirts. Like, I have shirts that I know I'm not going to wear again.
You know,
but when I throw out shirts, I'm like, I don't know, the brick shirt might need one more.
I do the same thing.
I think based on the fact that just like vinyl, I believe that there'll be a resurgence at some point in time in the CD world where I'll be able to buy more CDs.
There will be, but will you be part of it? Like, I always liked vinyl. When it flipped to the CD format, I hated the CD format. I just think they sound like crap. I just don't like them.
Yeah.
I never have. So I'm glad the vinyl has come back. Like, I've been waiting for this, but CDs, I don't know anyone who's like, come on, CDs, bring it back home.
Reason asks, what do you have too much of or need to get rid of? A Funko is dumping 30 million in unsold dolls. Those are the ones that grace Steve Miggs's desk back there, aren't they? Those are
the Funko dolls.
And he collects them, apparently. Well, Funko apparently overestimated demand for its bobble-headed pop culture collectible so badly, hundreds of thousands of them are doomed to end up in a landfill. In a trading update on Friday, the company says it plans to eliminate excess inventory for a write-down of at least $30 million. That's the company's way of saying its warehouses are overflowing with 5-inch replicas of Machine Gun Kelly.
What? Nobody wanted a Machine Gun Kelly Funko?
Spider-Man and Pikachu and every other vaguely famous cultural icon. And throwing them out will be cheaper than trying to sell them. The company says it has $246 million of inventory, up 48% from a year ago. Now, their sales figures did soar during the pandemic, but they are now stagnant.
So did bread makers.
So in its update, the company says that sales were down 1%. They have a storage and container rental charge associated with the inventory in excess of warehouse capability or capacity. The CEO said that they have been forced to rent extra space because its Arizona distribution center had run out of room for the dolls. The company also said it's laying off around 10% of its workforce. Now, speaking of a lot...
I will say, just on a quick side note, Comic-Con this weekend, Funko had pretty sizable presence in a couple of different locations.
They're super cool looking dolls.
They are. And my daughter and her friends, they know characters I know nothing about. I don't care. But they had this one massive display. And these girls stood there for probably 15 minutes looking at each, and they're still in the boxes, but looking at each an individual box and trying to speed the process along. And they kept saying, hey, baby, you see anything you like? Trying to say it. I will pay for this if we can hurry up. All five of these girls looked at everything they had. None of them bought anything. I could not believe it.
Nice.
Yeah.
Speaking of a lot of, this came out this past week. It's pretty interesting from the Academy of Sciences. Do you guys know what the Earth has approximately 20 trillion of? 20 trillion.
Is it a living thing?
It is a living thing on this planet.
Then it's an insect.
It is an insect.
I hope it's not mosquitoes.
Ants.
Hey, but they're predominantly underground, so I'm cool.
Scientists went on a quest to find out how many ants there are on Earth. This
one,
comes
two,
our way
three,
from,
four,
basically.
Five. Damn it!
Comes
one,
our
two.
Way from brobible.com. How many ants on the planet? 20 trillion. For anyone out there who isn't using, not used to seeing a number that large, that is 20000000000000000. In a new paper published by the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, a team of scientists blew the world away by revealing how many ants there are, and honestly, that number is so large that humans are not readily equipped to process it. By analyzing 489 studies, the team from the University of Hong Kong determined the total abundance of ground-dwelling ants estimated the number of all the ants on Earth. Put another way, the total biomass, total weight of all ants in existence, is 12 megatons of dry carbon, which is roughly equivalent to 20% of all human biomass on Earth.
Damn.
We are very lucky, they say, that most ants are relatively small. Still, when thinking about how many ants are on Earth, it's hard. Consider this quote from the Washington Post. If all the ants were plucked from the ground and put on a scale, they would outweigh all the wild birds and mammals put together on this planet. For every person on Earth, there are 2.5 million ants.
I can believe that, because of a family of four, I'd say about 10 million ants used to come into my house every spring.
Because of the food crumbs?
I don't know, man. It was little sugar ants, all right? So we have not had the problem in about 2 years. We hired some local company, some mom and pop place. They took care of the bees. They took care of the ants. I was not sold that they would take care of the ants. We tried a million things, but maybe about 3 weeks later than what it is now, they would start showing up. They showed up in droves and kind of disappeared toward the end of the summer. So I don't know what their cycle was, but it would just drive us crazy because, you know, certainly, and you know this when you have kids, kids are not good at resealing anything that's edible.
Right.
You know, whether it's, so the ants, you know, you go to dump a bowl of Lucky Charms and it's like, it's half ants, half Lucky Charms. And it did not matter how much I yelled about it, threatened them, whatever. But the sugar ants were one thing. When we lived in upstate New York, we had carpenter ants. And they're not huge, but they're considerably bigger than sugar ants. And they're little pinchers. They don't hurt.
Yep.
But they can grab your finger and, like, they won't let go. So, but the house was made of wood. So we did not know when we first bought the house that carpenter ants were a thing. We since learned a lot about them in the 4.5 years we were there. But what would bother me is this was late 70s, early 80s. So I got my little mini kid fro, man. You know what I mean? I want my spherical black man perfection. And I would wake up, I would go to take a shower, and as a guarantee, there's 3 or 4 dead ants in your hair. No, it's a guarantee, man. I mean, because they're walking across, and you realize, all right, if there's 3 dead ants in my hair, that probably means 50 of them walked across my face during the course of the night. But I mean, they were constant. They were everywhere.
I remember 2 infestations. One growing up in the house that my mom and my stepfather lived in, and they were all in the pantry. And they were these little tiny moths. And at some point, they get into flour. They get into an older box of cereal. My mom could not find, like, the nest of where all these eggs were. So she was constantly going through boxes, throwing away stuff. She'd look in the bag of the cereal and not realize that the moths were on the bottom of the box.
Right.
On the inside. And they would multiply. And they were the kind of moths where you swatted them, and they'd leave a little powdery substance.
Yeah.
And they were everywhere. I mean, you would open up the cabinet to get food, man, and they would because you just opened up the cabinet for the first time. There's 25 of them just flying around.
Are they still around?
I don't know.
Right.
Yes.
I remember that from childhood, but I have not seen that in like 30 years.
It's probably been near 10 years at this point. But we went through this in our pantry that we got one of those little moths in there somewhere, and I think it came in like a bag of rice or something like that.
You just got to throw almost all your food away. It's not canned.
The problem is that we built our pantry with that particle board where you kind of designed your own shelves where they're at. So they've got all these little bullet holes where you can put the pegs to make the shelves. And they had nested in every single one of those things, man.
They can eat through the aluminum on, like, my mom found them in Lipton soup packets.
Oh, yeah.
Really?
Oh, yeah. That was the problem with it, was that there are eggs in there. Yes, you better just cook whatever food. Like, you didn't want to just eat a graham cracker out of the cabinet because they could have very well been in there and dropped all their eggs in there, and then they would explode. Like, you wouldn't see, you'd see a package of food. It would be perfectly fine one day. The next day, you would look, and it's completely infested. So one day, these saltines look edible. The next day, the entire bag is filled with all these little larvae in there.
Yes.
Getting ready to turn into moths.
We'd get in there, they're crawling on the ceiling.
Exactly. They nested in the corners and all this
stuff. They're like Lionel Richie.
It was impossible to get rid of them. The other time was, I had a bird that nested in an outtake vent above my oven, where, you know, you put the exhaust fan on and this goes out. Well, the birds had figured a way. A sparrow figured out a way to lift that little flappy thing and nest in there. Now, I could hear them. I knew they were there.
Sure.
This is cool. I know they're going to leave, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I can hear the little babies chirping when this finally comes around. I can hear the mom coming in and bringing food because the little birds would lose their mind when their mom came back in. You could hear the flap. You could hear it. She's obviously got some food. All the little guys are going nuts and all that stuff. And then it got deathly quiet. 2 days, 3 days go by. I'm like, the birds, they've obviously gotten old enough. They have left the nest. So it was a pretty good drop. I went outside. I looked. There's nobody that fell out or anything. Everybody successfully flew out.
Sure.
Great. Whatever. 2 more days go by. And all of a sudden, these little white drops are falling from the screen that covered underneath my microwave where the outtake valve was to go for the exhaust fan. And they are falling and falling, and I'm looking, and it looked like someone had spilled a bag of flour, basically, on top of my oven. Now, I look upon closer examination. The smell emanating from this is the smell of absolute death. One of those little birds did not make it.
Right.
But all of these little mites, and they were white. They looked like lice, to be honest with you. Like, if I knew someone that had lice, this is what lice would look like. It looked exactly like crabs and lice. And I looked down, and they were crawling everywhere. And upon a magnifying glass and further inspection, when you saw these bugs, if they were bigger, you would be terrified of just their features and how they looked. And, I mean, they had little pinchers, and they were crawling around everywhere, and I was just like, oh, my God. So I had to hire somebody to come in, sweep out that vent. Then they had to exterminate my entire kitchen because those mites had run everywhere.
Yeah, of course.
I mean, especially when it comes to eating food in the food area.
How many days were you going through mite gate?
At least 4 or 5 days.
Ooh.
Because it took a little bit of time to just make sure that they were all killed, that I didn't have to worry about this problem anymore. He swept it out. Sure enough, there were two dead birds in there. But these mice were kind of, they were using that as like, we're going to grill in here for a minute.
Yeah, sure.
And then take over my entire kitchen. More of the Random Question coming up, 206-803-ROCK.
Imagine you're looking at a balancing scale with everything you do for other people on one side and everything you do for yourself on the other side. If it isn't balanced, maybe it's time to spend a little more time on you. And therapy is a great place to start. BetterHelp connects you with a licensed therapist online who can help you find that balance and stick to it. Visit BetterHelp.com/positive to get 10% off your first month. That's BetterHelp.com/positive.
What you watch depends on what kind of mood you're in. Sometimes you're craving comedies like Friends or South Park, and sometimes you're more into dramas like HBO's Succession and House of the Dragon. There's also cooking shows like Chopped and Beat Bobby Flay, and even movies like The Lord of the Rings and Shazam! Fury of the Gods. Well, Max is the streaming destination that has the best of entertainment for whatever mood you're in, anytime. And plans start at as little as $9.99 a month. Max, the one to watch. Subscription required. Visit max.com.
Love the skin you're in with Hand in Stone Massage and Facial Spa's facial services. Enjoy the tranquility and deep relaxation while giving your skin a rejuvenating glow. All facials are tailored to your individual needs using the highest quality ingredients designed to give you healthy, radiant, and younger looking skin. Visit any one of their 8 Seattle Hand in Stone Massage and Facial Spa locations or book online at handinstone.com. Restrictions apply. See spa for details.
If you're a contractor, it's now easier for you to do business with the Department of Labor and Industries. Go to lni.wa.gov/skip the line and make an appointment with us ahead of time. No waiting around. No wasted time away from your job site. You get in, get out, and get on your way. Easy. So contractors, just go to lni.wa.gov/skip the line to make an appointment and get back to doing what you do best.
99.9 KISW. The Men's Room returns with Miles and Thrill.
Categories are your 10 favorite meats and bed bugs. On your guess is as good as mine. In the meantime, it is our random question. 206-803-RIND.
Random.
Hello, Joe Dredd. Welcome to the Men's Room.
Hola, Pichola.
Hola.
Joe, welcome to the program once again. The random question. All right, this is a hypothetical. Might be a crazy sounding question.
Okay.
But how long do you believe that you can ride a bull for? If you had to get on top of a bull and ride it, even if it's a mechanical bull, whatever the deal is, how long do you think you could stay on
that
bull?
What does it say? Is it 8 seconds?
Eight seconds. Is the magic number.
Well, yeah, eight seconds is what they're shooting for. I have rode a mechanical bull down at Cowgirls, Inc. Years back, back when DJ was on the buzz. They had some listener parties down there, and I tried it, and the guy was very easy with me in the beginning, but I tell you, if it was a real bull, I'd be thrown off immediately.
Okay, all right. How well did you do on the mechanical bull? Because I know they can do it where it barely moves, or they can crank it up a bit, right?
Dude, I'm a musician. I don't have that kind of upper body strength to hold on.
Yeah.
Come on, man. Let's get real, right?
You don't think carrying all your Gene Simmons armor weight has helped give you some upper body strength?
No.
Okay.
No. It has taught me how to walk correctly in platform boots. That's about it.
Right.
You know?
They had, there was a bar kind of somewhere between Washington, D.C. and Baltimore. And I want to say it was called like the Cancun Cantina, whatever. Cancun, but they have live bulls. And you could go.
Live bulls?
They had live bulls. Really? They had a bull live ring bull on the side. Then somebody got hurt because they were doing it like as an amateur night, right?
Wait.
Live bulls?
They had live. Then they went back
amateur
in.
Amateur night at a bar to ride a live bull.
That sounds like an insurance liability.
It was.
Yeah.
They put you in pads and everything else. Then they decided to cut that short and they put in the mechanical bulls.
Yes.
So then they had two of those. And then someone got hurt even worse on one of those things.
They got hurt worse on the mechanical bull?
They did something to their neck. Whatever the deal is. I don't know. They turned those things up, man. It's 11:30. There's
you're drunk.
There's country music playing. I mean, they kind of cranked it up like Gillies in there. It was one half the bar, then the other half was like a rock and roll end or a dance end.
If I remember, like, by the time I was old enough to go, that place was like half of it was country, the other half was like rap.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
They adjust. It seems like rock goes the world of rap. Country always stays the same. Have, right? Have you Hammer guys? Jacks, right?
Yeah.
But I cannot believe that anyone, first of all, even if you had the idea of, hey, man, we're going to get some live bulls and we'll do amateur night. You know, for people mm-hmm. that don't normally ride freaking rodeo bulls, let's get them drunk, see how it goes. I would just think as you tried to get that past the city, they'd be like, yeah. Hey, man, look, it sounds fun, but guys, no. I mean, just absolutely not. That is the worst idea ever.
Yeah, the original Cancun Cantina Rodeo Team. I guess they have a team now, but back in the day, they used to have actual rodeo at the Cancun Cantina. So that was, because I had to go to a couple of the events down there for a radio station I worked at. And I was like, there's bulls in the bar. Like, here is the Cancun Cantina. And that's the outside of the bar. And they had bulls.
Did you watch people try to stand
yes,
bulls?
Yes. And then when they did the mechanical bull, I was there another time. And I could kind of get the weight down behind that a little bit better. Because, as Joe was saying, they kind of started slow. So you can kind of figure out how to adjust your weight, putting your weight on your toes or whatever the deal is, leaning back, learning that. But then it whip spins. So once that starts, man, now you're trying to hold on and do that stuff sideways, and it's going back and forth. It's dizzying. It feels like you've been shaken in a blender.
Well, guess what? Cancun Cantina is not alone. Two different people are letting us know. Now, there's a place in Dallas, Texas. It's a bar that has the same thing, has a rodeo rink in it. But now that said,
it's also Dallas.
It's called Billy Bob's. I just assume that a place called Billy Bob's might have some live bulls.
You would think so.
But still seems like a bad idea. But also, in Texas, I'm a lot more comfortable that there are people that have done this before
right.
than I am between Washington, D.C. and Baltimore.
Well, that's what I'm saying. That doesn't shock me because there's not like cowboy culture in the Mid-Atlantic.
At all.
Whereas
it's not
like
there.
Texas, right? Like this Billy Bob's is in Fort Worth. Fort Worth is famous for the stockyards.
Exactly.
Yep. Reason we asked, do you think you could ride a bull, and how long do you think you could ride it for? The Houston Livestock Show and Rodeo. Started up, and it runs through March 19th. It is the largest indoor rodeo in the world. So here's a fun question. Do you think you could ride an angry bull for 8 seconds without falling off? That's how long you'd have to stay on to score points.
If the professionals have a hard time doing that, why would anyone think that your dumb ass is going to hop onto an angry bull and do it better than
A new poll found a surprising number of us think we could do it. One in five Americans believe that they can stay on a bull for 8 seconds, 20% of people asked. Actually, it was 21% think they could stay on. That's 26% of men, 16% of women. Almost all those people are relatively young. Only around 5% of people over 45 said they could do it. Over 40% of Americans have been to a rodeo, according to the poll. If you haven't, you can do much better, they say, than the one in Houston, because a bunch of the big-name country artists are performing this year.
Okay.
So far, the headliners include, and you guys know country music better than I do recognize some of these names, but here playing at this rodeo this year to give you an idea. You guys have heard of Luke Bryan, right?
Yep. Of course.
You've heard of Brad Paisley.
Yep. He's from West Virginia.
You've heard of Chris Stapleton.
Yep.
Oh, yeah.
You've heard of Kenny Chesney.
Sure.
Jason Aldean.
Yep.
John Party.
Damn.
Zach Brown Band.
Nice.
Walker Hayes. Brooks and Dunn.
Jesus.
All playing the rodeo.
And those are all A-listers.
I know who they are.
That's bigger than most country music festivals.
By the way, this is, and I understand that most phones now, they autocorrect. And autocorrect is kind of a 50-50 shot. So they're talking about Billy Bob's down there in Fort Worth.
All right.
Now, I'm going to assume that what they meant was Billy Bob's is the world's largest honky-tonk. What we got is Billy Bob's. Where the hell to go? Billy Bob's, the world's largest honky, Tony.
Honky. Actually, that's what they say. Billy Bob's, the world's largest honky-tonk.
Yeah, I'm assuming you meant tonk. It came out, the world's largest honky, Tony.
Yeah.
Okay.
He probably lives in Jersey.
Why is he calling you Tony?
I don't know, man, but you know.
Hey, you calling me a freaking honky?
Hey, Tony, guess what,
you're a honky. I'm not a honky, I'm Italian.
I don't think who the biggest white guy is.
Biggest white guy. Who was the guy that was, who was the wrestler?
Big Andre bald the Giant?
Dude? No, not him. The bald dude.
Brock Lesnar.
No.
Big Show.
Goldberg?
Not Big Show.
Steve Austin.
He was just a fat dude, right? And he was...
Bam Bam Bigelow?
Butterbean?
Butterbean, thank you.
Oh, the fighter.
Jesus.
Okay,
yeah. Man, oh man. I'm like, I can picture this dude in my head. But yeah. That's the biggest white boy I ever seen. Look at that big white boy. Hello, Justin. Welcome to the men's room.
What's up?
Hola. Justin, welcome to the program. Random question. Let's go with this one.
Oh, man. I just Googled Butterbean. You're right. He's 378 pounds.
Brother,
that's what they have him listed as. Like, damn.
That's a big guy. What would you say is the oldest piece of technology that you still own? Not that you use it, but you still have it from back in the day.
Well, my grandfather passed, and I inherited all of his tools, and so the ones with dates on them. I've got a pipe wrench that goes back to 1911. I got some old hand drills and Yankee drills, and I got a bunch of old tools, but the oldest one that I know for sure is around 1911.
Does it still work? I mean, could you use it if you were doing a project?
Oh, yeah, bro, probably better than the pipe wrench you buy at the store today.
Huh, funny how that works, isn't it?
It's just probably more simple and basic.
Well, no,
it doesn't
like
break down as
any
much.
Smart company goes, man, we can't make something indestructible because they don't buy more.
Mm-hmm. How about from a tech standpoint? Do you have any old computers, old phones? I've got the thing that used to carry the music? An iPod?
iPod, yeah.
From Apple, where you spun the little dial and all the music came up?
Yeah.
I've still got mine.
Yeah, I don't have any more of those, but I got it's a desktop sewing machine that you plug into the sewing machine, plug into the wall, and it's got like the little pedal. And it's pretty old. I don't know how old, but that's probably the oldest technology type thing as far
as. Can you sew?
I don't have any old computers or typewriters or anything like that.
I want to get my hands back on the typewriter. My parents might still have it. They just left for New Mexico a couple of weeks ago. But growing up, you know, pre-computer, we had the big-ass Royal typewriter. Mm-hmm. And in spite of the fact, you know, fairly small size, but that thing had to weigh like 40 pounds. It was just, seriously, dude, it was, your parents would ask you to get it, and it took me and my brother to grab either side of this. It's about the length of a loaf of bread, but it's just this densely compact black hole of material.
Right.
And we'd carry it up so they could type whatever.
I've got the radio that I listen to in my living room is also Bluetooth in to my phone, so I can listen to all my music on that as well. But it's from 1919.
Yeah.
It's a General Electric radio. And there's the original tag on the inside. I know all the tubes have been replaced.
Of course.
Other general work has been done to it. But it's the original speaker.
Mm-hmm.
It does not have FM on it because there was no such thing. It's got these weird stations or weird bands that I can tune into, which are either some kind of shortwave or some kind of... Because one of the dials is ambulance, police, fire, that kind of thing. And certain things sound like Morse code. From, like, I don't know, like the Navy thing. I don't know who's using it, but just
I don't even know if you could legally, dude, I'm not 100% on this, but like anything. So just in the world of radio, right? So on the FM band, that's why stations go from, what, like 87.9 to 107.9.
Correct.
After that, anything below the 87.9, like a lot of that's military use and stuff. And that's why, so you'll never hear an FM station, quote unquote, below. I'm going to say it's 87.9, because below that, all of those things exist. But like I said, there's military stuff or whatever they use it for. And then again, at the higher frequencies, you can't use that. And that's why all radio and AM kind of has the same thing where not that anyone wants to listen to AM radio. But the same thing. If you cross over those bands, like you're listening to stuff you're not supposed to.
Raise me ask, what old piece of technology do you still own? They say if you take an original first generation iPhone into Verizon, say you're going to do a trade-in or whatever you're going to do, they might give you 63 cents. That is one that you've used. But a woman named Karen Green had an original iPhone from 2007, which was still factory sealed. Back then, 16 years ago, she had just scored a new management job at PetSmart. And to celebrate, her friends bought her an iPhone. But Karen never ended up opening it. She already had a phone, and she liked the phone she had, and she had a contract with Verizon. At the time, iPhones could only be used with AT&T.
That is correct.
But since it was a gift, she's like, hell with it. She just kept it. Well, a while back, she heard that a first-generation iPhone sold for thousands on eBay. She had it appraised in 2019 for $5,000. But now, she finally decided, you know what? I'm going to unload it. It sold at auction on Sunday. For any guesses, what the original iPhone...
12 grand.
From 2007. 12 grand, a little bit higher than that.
I'll say 25.
25? Mike, you got a guess?
I think it's like 40 grand.
At auction on Sunday, Karen sold her unopened iPhone for $63,356. It was expected to sell for $50,000 somewhere in there. Karen's friends probably paid, they're thinking maybe around $550 for the phone originally back in 2007.
Damn.
So yeah, she scored.
Wow.
That's crazy. Yeah, it's just in your drawer. Random, I have no idea.
Dig through all my old dead phones. Random.
Hello? Are they unopened?
Well, that is the problem, Ted.
I'm with you. I have probably four of them I can put my hands on.
You're absolutely
They're
right.
They're well used.
Yes, well used. Hello, Jolene. Welcome to the men's room.
Hola.
Hola.
Jolene, welcome to the program and the random question. All right, Jolene, let's go with this one. Hopefully this is not too crass, but it's an interesting study they did. Jolene, when was the last time that you say you you took care of yourself there? Gave yourself a little personal one-on-one time.
Oh, I shaved my face yesterday.
You did what now?
I shaved my face yesterday.
You shaved your face. Okay.
That's terrifying in and among itself, but we're talking more about masturbation.
Yes.
Oh. Well, my parents are listening, so.
So never.
Never.
Okay.
Do you have a beard?
Yeah, you have no problem telling your parents that you shaved your face.
Your face,
it's
all right?
Peach fuzz. It's not a beard.
All right.
Okay. All right. How often do you have to shave your face free from the peach fuzz?
Well, I mean, I should do it once a week, but it's usually like every 4 months.
All right. Not the worst thing in
now,
the world.
If you
quarterly.
Say you went 6 months without shaving. I see you at the bar. Am I going to notice that you have a fuzzy face, or is it just you worrying that you have a fuzzy face?
Well, is the bar dark, or are we outside?
No, well, you know, right. It's daytime. Well, we're daydreaming.
You know like, what? You answered the question.
Well, it's like when the sun comes in your window and hits the hardwood floor, and you haven't seen the sun in a while,
right,
you realize, oh, my God, my floor is filthy. Is same way for you?
Yep.
Okay. That's a very interesting conversation.
When I'm driving in the car, and I see myself in the mirror that's facing, you know, I'm supposed to be looking at traffic, but I'm looking at myself.
That's comforting. Mm-hmm. Are you like a redhead or a blonde?
Well, I want to be a blonde, but now it's turning into gray and like this dark and, yeah.
All right, because if you're a brunette, like it's, cause I remember being in school, there were a couple of redheads, a couple of blondes. And they'd have, quote, unquote, peach fuzz, but you didn't care because, like Miles said, there had to be, like, light
it's
behind
like, it's
you.
It's like baby hair. It's like,
right.
Yeah.
But if you're a brunette.
Well, so it is, it's baby hair, but it gets, when the sun hits it, it shimmers.
I mean, I think if you're old enough to have gray hairs, you're old enough for your parents to know you've masturbated before.
Stop.
All right.
Okay. All right. You know, when's the last time you masturbated? I shaved my face. Didn't I see that coming?
Last week, maybe.
Yeah, I think maybe Thursday, man. But like I said, I had a busy. It's not that I didn't want to. There was just no opportune time.
Oh, really?
Yeah, well, look, man.
Last night.
You got to deal with kids. You know, you want them to go to bed and all that kind of thing. And then, like, well, if I'm upstairs, dog's hanging out. If I'm downstairs, a cat's staring at me. Cats make it real weird. Because cats just stare at me.
What are you doing?
And I mean, the dog will at least leave, like, oh, I don't, you're making me uncomfortable. Sorry. The cat's just like, yeah, I see what you're doing there, playboy.
Well, believe it or not, the reason we asked, when was the last time you masturbated? A new survey and study says abstaining from masturbating raises risk of anxiety, depression, and erectile dysfunction. Participating in what they call the no-fap technique may lead to devastating mental health issues.
No-fap technique.
According to a new study. Born out of groups on Reddit, the movement urges men to avoid masturbation to boost confidence, focus, and even cure erectile dysfunction.
That's stupid.
Now, those who abide by the practice even call themselves fapstronauts. Well, research at the University
of
California.
Still not cool. Don't try to make it cool.
They surveyed 587 men who had taken part in the abstinence practice. They found that men said they felt worthless, shame, sad, and in some cases, suicidal. When they relapsed, they were also more likely to report erectile dysfunction. Now, experts support occasional masturbation and sex for its many health benefits. Harvard University survey found that study found that men who ejaculate at least 21 times a month slash their risk of prostate cancer by a third.
Oh, I'm good.
So the UCLA scientists also found that many people on the online forums seeing the no-fap lifestyle were doing so with little scientific backing. There's no scientific determined number for how often a man or woman should masturbate. But medical professionals do urge people to undertake the habit occasionally, saying it can help reduce your stress, improve your self-esteem, and even for men, reduce the risk of prostate cancer. They say when people masturbate, it prompts the release of feel-good hormones like oxytocin and endorphins, which boost mood. There is also no figure on how often someone should have sex, but scientists have suggested to the DailyMail.com about once a week. If you can get it that much, you'll be okay.
All right, there you go.
But also,
they say how much is too much?
Yeah. They say part of the allure of the NoFap lifestyle is the claim that it treats your pornography addiction.
Correct.
So the scientists behind the study say there's no medical backing to claims that are made on the forum. They have previously suggested, however, that if you're into the pornography thing and you're maybe an addict, it would maybe not be the worst thing in the world if you cut back on that and did some other things.
Well, sure, water is very good for you, but there's a point where you're drinking too much water.
Exactly. Your guess is as good as mine. Coming up, our categories today, the top 10 tastiest meats and the biggest cities for bed bugs. You are listening to The Men's Room.
You diet, you work out, and still there's that one stubborn spot. Hey, it's Jason. I just went after my stubborn fat by doing Cool Sculpting at Terrine Dermatology, Minnesota's top Cool Sculpting provider. Dr. Terrine is my dermatologist. We froze my fat, and those fat cells are gone for good. FDA approved. No pain, no downtime. Ranked top doctor 8 years in a row. Trust the experts at Terrine Dermatology. Call today, 651-633-6883, and say goodbye to stubborn fat.
T-Mobile's network can help keep you connected to all your favorite podcasts when you're out and about. Whether you're an early bird looking to dive into a daily news podcast or a night owl who wants to catch up on the latest reality TV drama, T-Mobile will keep you connected on their strong and reliable network. T-Mobile covers more highway miles with 5G than anyone. So if you need great coverage, especially when you're on the go, check out T-Mobile. Find out more at T-Mobile.com/CY. That's SEEWHY.
Odyssey celebrates Pride by amplifying the voices, music, and conversations of the LGBTQ+ community. Download the free Odyssey app and listen to podcasts celebrating and having conversations about the issues facing LGBTQ+ Americans, like It's Okay to Say Gay, Queer Intentions, and The Bald and the Beautiful with Trixie Mattel and Katia Zamo. To hear music by and for the LGBTQ+ community, plus podcasts and more, go to odyssey.com/pride or download the free Odyssey app. That's AUDACY.
If you're a contractor, it's now easier for you to do business with the Department of Labor and Industries. Go to lni.wa.gov/skip-the-line and make an appointment with us ahead of time. No waiting around. No wasted time away from your job site. You get in, get out, and get on your way. Easy. So contractors, just go to lni.wa.gov/skip-the-line to make an appointment and get back to doing what you do best.
Most of you listening right now are probably multitasking. Yep, while you're listening to this, you're probably also driving, cleaning, exercising, or maybe even grocery shopping. But if you're not in some kind of moving vehicle, there's something else you can be doing right now. Getting an auto quote from Progressive Insurance. It's easy, and you could save money by doing it right from your phone. Drivers who save by switching to Progressive save nearly $700 on average, and auto customers qualify for an average of 7 discounts. Discounts for having multiple vehicles on your policy, being a homeowner, and more. So just like your favorite podcast, Progressive will be with you 24/7, 365 days a year. So you're protected no matter what. Multitask right now. Quote your car insurance at progressive.com to join the over 29 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. National average 12-month savings of $698 by new customers surveyed who saved with Progressive between June 2021 and May 2022. Potential savings will vary. Discounts not available in all states and situations.
Have you or a loved one been injured in an accident? Are you struggling to recover fair compensation? Look no further. At Phillips Law Firm, the experienced personal injury attorneys will fight for your rights and get you the justice and compensation you deserve. They handle a wide range of cases, including car accidents, slip and falls, medical malpractice, and workplace injuries. Justice is a phone call away, so don't wait. Call today for a free case review. Call 1-800-JUSTICE or visit justiceforyou.com.
What's up? It's your boy, The Ben Smith. Thanks for listening to the Men's Room Daily Podcast. Want more? Check out the greatest podcast in all the land, the podcast. Be sure to subscribe and listen to a brand new episode every Tuesday night.
The debauchery rolls on. You're listening to The Men's Room with Miles and Thrill. 99.9 KISW.
Your guess is as good as mine. Cut out the categories, tasty meats and bed bugs. But first time for a few emails from The Men's Room at KISW.com.
You've got mail.
Jump right into the birthdays, guys. I want to wish my boyfriend Hendrick, also called Shane, McYetzy, Hank, Hankrick, and too many other nicknames, a very happy 22nd birthday. Can we get a Pat Sajak and a cut that bitch off? He has the best sense of humor I've ever seen and will forever go on the record to say that his girlfriend is completely average height.
She wants a D and she's going to get one.
Cut that bitch off! Next caller.
Please sing the birthday song to my beautiful daughter, Raven V. She turns 31. Makes fun that I turned 50. Maybe add a little something from the Dirty Germans. You guys are awesome. Thank you, guys. That from Deira and who else? Her siblings, Isis and Osiris.
Oh. That's just three.
31.
All I heard was 3. I was like,
Yeah, that changes everything. Yeah, now I can talk about where I plan on putting my fingers, all of them, both hands, one spot.
Yeah, you know, you just keep making fun of your father. 31. Like, yeah, you'll be there soon.
All the men's room is my boyfriend's 35th birthday. He listens to the show on his way to and from work and thinks the Dirty Germans are hilarious. So, could you guys give him a proper shout-out? Please encourage him to get a little tonight at our weekly karaoke night with friends. His nickname, by the way, is String Beans. Monday nights, baby. Green kind bean. Regards. That from Stephanie.
Green beans.
Yeah, I like the idea of just karaoke nights with friends. You know, in Germany, we just call that a regular night.
Yeah, so I was him. I would just pass around some microphone.
Yeah. Song 69, please.
Guys, today marks mine and my twin brother's 35th trip around the sun to celebrate this milestone. Could you please give Justin a fish sandwich medley? Followed by the Dirty Germans talking about his work on nuclear submarines at the Bremerton shipyard. Very best to you and yours. That from Jason.
Can I get a filet of fish sandwich? So you know I got
I have a
right.
fish sandwich.
Oh, brother, can I have a fish sandwich? Put the cheese and the tartar on the side.
I'll order a fish sandwich.
Is it too early for a fish sandwich? Cheese and tartar on the side.
Oh, yeah.
I smell the fish sandwich. Maybe eat your relish in the morning.
Fish sandwich.
At noon. And at night.
Can I buy you a fish sandwich?
Though you don't want a fish sandwich?
Yeah, I do not have anything nuclear on my body, but obviously if you like working on things that are long, black, and like being wet, I have something for you.
Yes, you know, sometimes we can play nuclear submarine, and while we're having sex, I'll go silent mode.
Yeah.
You won't know where I am, but you'll know what the torpedo is.
Yeah. Hunt for peak October.
Guys, please wish a happy birthday to Darren, pronounced Darina Mangina. Have Cabin Crunch give him a lecture on keeping the mangina seaworthy. Thanks, guys. That from John.
Ooh, well, ahoy there. You know, it's funny you bring up the seaworthy mangina. Just last week at the International Seaworthy Mangina Awards were held in Bermuda. The International Seaworthy Mangina Awards are held every year, and normally yours truly, the old Gabby Dan, does quite well, but sadly not this year. Now, the most seaworthy mangina award this year went to that pesky Captain Morgan. But I still did better than Cracker Jack. The judges said he's more gina than man. And Aunt Jemima screamed, "Preach!" Run your bags.
Hey, guys, please have Coach Ted hype Steve up on finding a date for his birthday, followed by a little turtle sex and maybe a bong rip. Happy birthday, Steve. Lots of love. That from Princess.
What's that, Dad?
I mean, Steve, I think it's pretty simple, man. You go to a bar or a cocktail place, you go in there tonight, tomorrow, hell, do it all week. You lay on thick, not too thick, that it's your birthday. You know what? It's your birthday. Use a little poetic license, if you will. Maybe a lie about your job, your income. Who cares? It's your birthday week. Make a memory.
All right, guys, here you go.
Happy, happy, happy birthday. Happy, happy, happy birthday. Happy, happy, happy birthday to you, to you, to you.
Yaz, a dirty German, is brought to you by Men's Room Original Sausage. Available through Uli's World Famous Sausage, mensroomlive.com, and other fine retailers. Mmm, Schweinefleisch.
Thank you, Bob. Let's get a contestant on the line now. For your guess is as good as mine, 206-803-ROCK. In the meantime, a couple of extra emails. Subject is Comic-Con. All the great to see on Saturday at Comic-Con Thrill. So I talked to the other Jedi. You're right. Everyone in the Jedi community loves your show.
Mm-hmm.
That from John H. Is that true?
Yeah, John H. was dressed as a Jedi, and he said, "Hey, man, love the show." I said, "I'm not surprised. We do very well in the Jedi demographic."
Well, that's a good thing.
One of our biggest ones. Like, yeah, apparently, yeah. People that can use the Force love this show. They don't even need a radio.
This one says, Mr. The Ted Smith.
Mm-hmm.
Coming down from Victoria, B.C. to watch the Oilers take on the Kraken March 18th. Looking for some insight on any pregame activities in or around the area. It's a 1 o'clock in the afternoon game, so not sure what the level of excitement is to expect. Maybe there's a good breakfast joint that would lead right into the game time. Anything would be appreciated, my man. You know who it is. It's James.
I mean, look, there's a lot of new places up by that arena that are pretty good. I know there's a nice little Mexican place right there. I mean, classic Seattle. You could always go to the Mecca, which is up in that neighborhood on Lower Queen Anne. What's the place you were talking about last week, Miles? The Creole kind of place.
Toulouse Petite.
Yeah, that's a little more expensive, but very good food, very good cocktail.
And Five Point, if you're looking for a good dive bar with great food all the way around. It's not close
right,
to
that's
the
what
arena.
I was saying. That's why I said Mecca, because it's the same people. And like the Mecca is very close to the arena.
To me, I feel like Mecca is where I go afterwards. That's just me, just my mindset going in there. You know?
Yep. You never had breakfast in there?
I have not. For me, if I did a breakfast at a dive bar, it was simply the Five Point.
All right.
I did not realize Mecca did a breakfast.
Yeah. They're the same bar.
Are they?
Yeah. Okay. Same owner, same menu.
You just said that. Son of a
That's
bitch.
That's what I'm saying. Like, I know. When I lived in Belltown, we did them kind of interchangeably.
Okay. All right.
And one more. Where was I when I touched cotton? But y'all, the only time I was seriously touched cotton, and worse, happened on New Year's Day 2021. Just over 2 years ago. At the time, I used to go on long walks over 5 miles just to relax. So I was out on one of my long walks when suddenly my gut started rumbling. Uh-huh. To clarify, I had been on a steady diet of vodka, wine, pizza, and Chinese takeaway for the last several days leading up to the new year. But I felt just fine when I left on my walk. The problem was that I was still about 2 miles from home, and this was early 2021 when England still had some COVID lockdown restrictions in force. So, given the pubs were closed, I couldn't slip into one to unleash my fury. Part of my walk was through a big, massive park, and I probably could have done my business there, considering it was January and dark by four, but I had nothing to wipe with. So, you know how the closer you get to the toilet, the more you really, really got to go?
Oh, yeah.
I did manage to make it home, but I couldn't even make it up to the stairs to the bathroom. I dashed into my bedroom and immediately touched cotton before dropping trowel and completely exploding into my little office waste bin. And then there was the splashback on the carpet. It was a horrible way to start what ended up being a horrible year, as I broke my back later that year, and now I can't go on my long walks these days. I'll take crapping in a waste bin any day over breaking a vertebrae. Cheers, guys. That from Sean in England. All right, time for a little Your Guess Is As Good As Mine. It's a neat game to play. We get a contestant on the line. You pick from one of two categories and see if you can get as many right in said category before three strikes and you're out. So, Steve, who is our contestant? Ready to play Your Guess Is As Good As Mine.
I have no idea, but she says her name is Bree. Hello, Bree. Welcome to the men's room.
Hello.
Hola.
Bree, welcome to the program. And Your Guess Is As Good As Mine. Yes. All right, Bree, you get to pick from one of two categories. As Orkin has released its annual list of the cities in the United States with the most bed bugs. So we do have the top 10 for you on that. And then in another poll, we have the most favorite meats here in the United States. To give you an idea, 2 are fowl, 3 are crustacean, 1 is a fish, and 4 are what I call four-legged meats. So you want to go with the top 10 meets there, Bree, or the list of the cities with the most bed bugs?
Bree, I don't know about you, but to me, those are one and the same. Delicious bed bugs.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to do the bed
bugs? You want to do the bed bugs?
Sure.
All right, Bree. As we told you, Orkin just posted its 2023 list of the top cities for bed bugs. Orkin ranks the top 50 cities for bed bugs by looking at how many people had to use exterminators over the past 12 months. It's basically just that simple. So you know how the game is played. Get as many right in the category. There are 10 before 3 strikes and you're out. So what is going to be your first guess in the city that has the most bed bugs?
Seattle.
Not on the list. Actually, Seattle does relatively well in the world of bedbugs, believe it or not.
I mean, I would start with just big populated cities like New York,
D.C.,
Boston.
All right. How about Chicago?
Chicago's number one.
Oh, wow.
There you go. Hey. Not only is Chicago number one, but Chicago is number one for a third straight year. Congratulations.
Oh, they know Chicago. That is huge.
Yeah. Okay. What is your next guess?
Florida. Oh, you need a city.
A city.
But, how about Miami?
Not on the list.
No.
Bree, think old cities that are not really, really hot.
New York, New York.
That is number two. New York City is two on the list.
Okay. Las Vegas.
Las Vegas, not on the list. Again, think older.
Not on the list. You can get a lot of different things in Las Vegas. Bedbugs, not one of them.
What was the other one she got right, Miles? What was
she got
two?
Chicago number one and New York City number two on the list.
All right.
By the way, Ted, Washington, D.C. was number one just 3 years ago, but Chicago just came in and kicked their ass.
That's what happened.
Hey, look, sometimes you just want to be the champ.
Okay.
All right. So would that put D.C. still on the list somewhere?
One would think, Mike.
Yes, it would.
Number nine.
All right. Good for D.C. dropping precipitously off those lists.
Okay.
You said Boston.
No one had said Boston yet.
Boston. Now.
Boston, right,
how about
list.
How about Philadelphia?
I'm about to go Philly.
Philadelphia is number three.
Hey,
on the list of the cities with the most bed bugs. So Chicago number one, New York number two, Philly number three.
I mean, I would say, did you already say Baltimore?
No one has said Baltimore.
Baltimore.
Number eight.
Cool.
I'm just going down.
Right,
95.
We're driving 95.
Yep, not a bad idea.
What about, I was going to say Detroit.
Detroit is number six.
Okay. I figure if they're in Chicago, why not go to Detroit?
Mm-hmm. Right. What a place like Cleveland.
Cleveland is number four.
Wow. How about a place like Cleveland?
Okay. Yeah. We've got one on the West Coast.
L.A.
We've got two, basically, what I would consider to be middle America, okay. Although they're more east than the Mississippi.
St. Louis?
St. Louis is not on the list.
How about San Francisco?
San Francisco, not on the list.
All right.
So,
L.A. Here on the coast.
L.A., number five.
It is L.A.
There's the West Coaster. Now we have two what I'd like to call Middle America cities. One is a state capital. I believe both are state capitals.
Indianapolis.
Indianapolis, number seven.
Really, Indianapolis?
Yep.
You got nothing going on, but you have time for bed bugs.
Look at St. Elmo's fire.
They just had the combine.
Mm-hmm. Is it that? Oh, God. All the players are all itching now.
Yeah. I'll give you a hint. Let's see.
He said it's the state capital.
One of our sports teams recently passed through on their East Coast jaunt. This is a state capital.
Okay. Columbus.
Columbus, Ohio.
Ah, well done.
Number wow, two. So I'm trying to. There's only so many state capitals.
They went from Detroit to
that
Columbus.
Have real, like, pro exactly. teams.
That would be so cracking.
Right. Columbus actually has a pro hockey team.
So according to Orkin, here is a list of the cities with the most bed bugs. At number 10, Columbus, Ohio. Coming in at number 9, Washington, D.C., followed by Baltimore at 8. 7 is Indianapolis. 6 is Detroit. L.A. at 5. Cleveland at 4. Philly is 3rd, and New York is 2nd. The number one city for the 3rd year in a row with the most bed bugs is Chicago, Illinois.
All right, go through the list again. Show of hands, who's been there?
So Chicago, been
there. Been to Chicago.
Been to Chicago.
I've flown through Chicago, but I can't say that I've been there.
New York City.
Been there.
Been in New York. Yeah. I've stayed.
Just when I was younger.
That's
yeah,
as
I've
an
stayed
adult.
In New York City. Right. I've stayed in Chicago.
I have not been to New York City.
Philadelphia is 3rd.
Been to very recently, I was in Philadelphia.
So
yes.
I've been to Philly, but I've never actually spent the night there.
Now, I did not spend a night in a hotel. I've spent a night at an in-law's house, but it doesn't mean they don't have bed bugs.
Sure.
No, it's just funny because Philly's so close to D.C. and Baltimore. But
you
like,
would just drive home.
We would drive up there for like a sports event or something, but like we always drove back the
Absolutely.
Same day.
Cleveland, Cleveland, Ohio.
Been to Cleveland.
I have not been to Cleveland.
I have been to Cleveland.
That's where you got in that weird hotel, right?
The weird hotel.
Were you in like in a strange section of town based on where the auction
yes,
was or
yes,
something?
Exactly. So the hotel was like attached to either a hospital or a hospital / medical school. So there's nothing around there, and I'm going right back this year. So I had a great time.
Mike, I don't know what
fun.
You know about major cities, but whenever you get near a hotel, I'm sorry, a hospital. There is sketchy stuff going around the
oh,
hospitals
there is.
In almost
yeah.
every major metropolitan area. I don't know why that is.
Because there's
it
drugs.
It doesn't matter
in
the city.
Drugs.
That's got
to
be it.
You get a lot of people that are just being released from the hospital for whatever it is they've
sure.
done to themselves, so to speak. But they don't really wander far because there's nowhere to go. Right. So if you don't have cash for a cab, you just kind of hang out there. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I will say, though, I have a buddy from out here, Dave. He moved to Cleveland. He loves it. Well, I guess maybe he's from there originally, from Ohio.
Okay.
But he talks about, I think Cleveland is doing and I make fun of Cleveland all the time.
Sure.
So don't get me wrong.
What happened there? Mind your mustache?
To do a good job of kind of like Pittsburgh did of revitalizing the city.
Pittsburgh's doing it. Baltimore's doing it. Cleveland's doing it. Pittsburgh's lucky it's got out of the slump, so to speak. But your reputation, in spite, like, Cleveland set the lake on fire. Like, it was in the 1960s.
How about Los Angeles?
Still make fun of them for it.
I've been to L.A. You guys been to Detroit?
Been to Detroit?
Detroit. I've only done for a day. I've never actually, like, stayed there. Detroit? Nope. Just the airport. That doesn't count.
Indianapolis? Never been there.
I've never been to Indy.
Not been to Indy, no.
I will go one time to Indy for, if nothing else, just to go see the 500. Because that's one of the greatest spectacles in sports. I think they call it the greatest spectacle in auto racing.
Yeah, Baltimore, obviously at 8, we've been there. Washington, D.C., obviously at 9, we have been there. Columbus, Ohio, I have driven through Columbus.
Never been to Columbus.
Never spent any time.
So I've been to 80% of the bedbug capitals.
Have you guys ever seen or experienced bedbugs?
No.
No,
I never have. I mean,
when did you find out they were real? I did not find out they were real until there was a big breakout in New York City, maybe a decade ago.
Right.
Because your parents would always say, good night, sleep tight, don't let the bedbugs bite.
Right.
I just assumed it was a saying.
Now,
so as a grown-ass adult, when they said bedbugs are real, I'm like, oh, Jesus.
Now,
man.
What is a bedbug when it's not in the bed? Like, is it just like a form of lice? Is it an ant? What is a bedbug?
It's something that
Mike,
you don't
want.
Mike,
that's a good question, right?
It's just a bug, but it ain't bed.
If it's not, right, because, like...
Yeah, what does it look like?
Like, for me, it's the same thing as a lice. It's just it's a bug that just lives in hair. I don't know where the hell it lives other than hair, but that's where you find it. Same with the bed bugs. I don't know where in the hell a bed bug lives that's not inside of a bed.
We call them crabs if you got them on your genitals, but it's lice if it's just in your hair.
Yeah, exactly. Now,
they're the same thing, though.
It's the same thing.
Gotcha.
Coming up, we'll drink a toast with a shot of the day. You are listening to The Men's Room.
Walk the dogs, school drop-off, meetings from 10 to 3, take kids to soccer, then no time left for a jog.
When everyone else is relying on you, it's easy to put your needs last. BetterHelp connects you with a licensed therapist online, so you can show up for yourself the way you do for others. Visit betterhelp.com/positive to get 10% off your first month. That's betterhelp.com/positive.
What you watch depends on what kind of mood you're in. Sometimes you're craving comedies like Friends or South Park, and sometimes you're more into dramas like HBO's Succession and House of the Dragon. There's also cooking shows like Chopped and Beat Bobby Flay, and even movies like The Lord of the Rings and Shazam! Fury of the Gods. Well, Max is the streaming destination that has the best of entertainment for whatever mood you're in anytime. And plans start at as little as $9.99 a month. Max, the one to watch. Subscription required. Visit max.com.
Love the skin you're in with Hand in Stone Massage and Facial Spa's facial services. Enjoy the tranquility and deep relaxation while giving your skin a rejuvenating glow. All facials are tailored to your individual needs using the highest quality ingredients designed to give you healthy, radiant, and younger looking skin. Visit any one of their 8 Seattle Hand in Stone Massage and Facial Spa locations or book online at handinstone.com. Restrictions apply. See spa for details.
If you're a contractor, it's now easier for you to do business with the Department of Labor and Industries. Go to lni.wa.gov/skip-the-line and make an appointment with us ahead of time. No waiting around. No waste of time away from your job site. You get in, get out, and get on your way. Easy. So contractors, just go to lni.wa.gov/skip-the-line to make an appointment and get back to doing what you do best.
99.9 KISW. The shenanigans continue. This is the Men's Room with Miles and Thrill.
All right, got a minute. We'll drink a toast for the shot of the day. And we do have your headlines on the way at 5:50. But first, quick check out with Mike Hawk and some of the stories and headlines he is not working on.
All right. Sorry. A new study found that people use emojis to hide their true feelings just as much as they use them to express them.
In what way? How would you hide your emotion if you use an emoji?
Basically, you use a laughy face when you're not actually laughing.
Well, sure.
You use a smiley face when you're not actually smiling. That kind of thing.
Okay.
Right.
I mean, I just make that assumption. If you send me the laughy face, I don't honestly assume
that you're sad.
Yeah, holding your belly laughing.
Right. You know. If I send you three or four of those, just know that I laughed a little bit at what you said.
I laughed, right. If I get three or four, like, okay, they chuckled.
Hey, I said something actually funny there. 64% of people say the invention of the internet was a good thing for humanity.
Yeah.
And on the overall grand scheme, yes, I do believe that the internet was a good thing. Has it been abused? 100%.
I think that's the bottom line. The right. internet itself is not a problem.
No.
It's what you choose to do with
it's
it.
It's the morons that are on there.
Right. Like, a hammer is a great tool, but if I beat people in the head, well, it's right. not the hammer's fault.
Don't blame the hammer right. for it. Balenciaga is selling a baseball cap that's been destroyed by a laser for $360.
You know,
is that a fashion thing?
They will.
Because people yeah. will buy it. That's because it's Balenciaga.
That's what I have found with anything that Balenciaga ever releases. It's just garbage that they put Balenciaga on, and then that justifies a $500 tab.
Because then people know that you have money.
Right.
Right. I mean, that's kind of the whole sales pitch, right?
And it's where they're just goofing on everybody at this point. Like, we can literally grab anything, and just people are buying our name at this point.
That is it.
You know?
And good for that.
Yeah.
You've gotten to the point that people will buy a complete piece of garbage because you put your name on it. You go, right. cool.
Some of it, too, it's like, I don't know who you're impressing.
Right.
You got to kind of know that stuff.
Yeah.
If you live in Bellevue, you got a shot, right?
Yeah, because there's certain brands and clothes where I look at, like, I have no idea what that is. And somebody's like, oh, it's this or that. I'm like, oh, okay.
Right.
I thought you were just wearing off-brand white sneakers.
Exactly.
I realized they were like $2,000 sneakers.
For some off-brand white sneakers. Cool. Right.
And that's where I tend to sit is that, you know, if I were to look at somebody and I would never actually make a comment on it, but I'd sit there and, you know, maybe I'd say to my buddy, like, well, those shoes are just, you know, those are off-brand nasty little shoes.
Sure.
No, man, those shoes are actually $2,000. I look at it and say, then you just burned $1,995.
Yeah, and I get it. I feel like somehow nowadays there's a lot of people that really can't, and it's fine. Like, that's an sure. upper echelon group of people. But, like, is it worth it to have that one thing that costs thousands of dollars?
Right.
It'd be better to spend $20 on the cap of the band or the sports team you like, wear it long enough, it'll look the same.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Yeah, I mean, I get pissed off that hats are $35 now.
For real.
Man.
Come on.
Chucks. Chucks used to be in the big wire bin next to the checkout at grocery stores.
Mm-hmm.
And your parents, you did not want them to buy them for you, right? But they bought them for you. So like $5 for a pair. What size shoe you wearing now? 8. They found a spare 8 and they throw them in. Now, you buy a pair of Chucks. Well, it's a fashion statement.
Like, right.
Tater tots, plaids with ribbon Chucks.
I mean, even like, look, I love Air Maxes. I always thought they were fashionable. And I think it's awesome that they become so fashionable now, but now everybody rocks them.
Right, so it kind of kills your vibe. Come on, man.
Damn. Dippin' Dots is releasing a new icy cherry blue Razz flavor.
Hmm. Okay.
I don't know where you get Dippin' Dots these days. I guess they still have the retail locations.
Other than a ballpark, yeah.
That's where I go.
Outside of boardwalks, does Dippin' Dots have brick and mortar stores?
I have yet to see
one. I've never seen one.
Yeah, I mean, I've only seen them at sporting events and like boardwalks.
I haven't even seen them on the boardwalks. I just only ever see them at a sporting event.
Well,
I don't do a whole lot of boardwalks.
I was going to say, the Pacific Northwest beaches, like here in Oregon, don't exactly say hang out all day on
the
boardwalk.
Come on down. Our beaches are cold.
Yeah, but when you're on the East Coast, especially where we lived, you know what I mean? Like, boardwalks are, they go for blocks upon blocks, and there's all these stores and bars sure. and restaurants.
Yeah.
It's a thing, too, man. You just stroll the boardwalk.
Why not?
Yeah. At the end of the pier, there's rides and stuff. Mm-hmm. You'd like, actually, Mike, you'd really like the boardwalk.
I'd probably love
now
it.
Now that I'm talking about it, like, I go to the boardwalk right now.
There's a new app that can tell if your first date is going well or not.
You can't figure that out on your own?
Yeah, it's called You.
You need the app on?
For real. If you actually need an app to tell you whether or not it's going well.
That means you
it's
would have
not
to going open well. The app, and the app would have to be listening and interpreting your conversation.
Right. If you need an app to tell you whether or not your date is going well, you're not ready to date.
I'm going
to
put this phone on the middle of the table here, and I'm going to record everything we're saying so we can see if this is working or not.
How does it work?
That's a good question, Ted.
Besides, right. If you use me, it's not working.
Right.
Once you open the app, it's not going well.
You literally open it up and says, look at their face. Are they bored?
Are they on their phone too?
Yeah, that's right.
Because right now you're the rude one. Yeah.
First off, are you in the bathroom? If you're at the table, no, it's not going well.
Yeah.
You done did fail. As we go throughout our lives, there's these things that we encounter that we don't ever really talk about. but they kind of wig us out or even scare the living daylights out of us, and that does bring us to
the Men's Room Top 10. The Men's Room Top 10.
The top 10 things that scare the living daylights out of people. Here's one. That weird jelly preservative stuff surrounding a canned ham. But if there's one thing that scares me more than anything else, it's waking up and there's a small child standing at the side of the bed, just staring back at you. Go away, Satan.
It's only weird for him because he doesn't have kids.
Because he doesn't have any
Which makes
children.
It really, really terrifying.
That's spooky.
Hey, baby, whose kid is this?
So these are the 10 common things that scare the living daylights out of people. At number 10, they go with abandonment. They get a little bit deep there. It says having the feeling that they're going to leave, honestly, the scariest thing ever. One person confessed, another volunteered. I used to get into these anxiety loops all the time where I despair about that. I learned this year that telling myself, hey, they're still around, alive right now, and so are you. There's boundless potential, boundless hope for the life that I want for them to be in it.
Jesus, man.
Yeah.
Lighten up.
It gets deep there right at the very beginning.
Well, so stop saying you want to leave then.
They're worried about
how about
them
that, Janice?
Or that people are around them are going to die.
I think a bit of both. They're worried of people around them either leaving of their own recognizance or just passing on. So one of the two is going to happen.
Man, they need to pick me up. Jesus.
They really do. Number 9, they go sleep paralysis. I've only ever heard about this. I have never known anybody that has had sleep paralysis.
It's happened to me once or twice. It's really weird.
About to say, did you see some weird ghostly figure that a lot of them do?
I just couldn't move my body. Like, that's it literally craziness. Took me a while to get my brain to go, okay, body, move.
Right.
I felt
right.
like I'd stopped breathing.
Jesus.
So I was like, oh, God.
It says the worst ones are multi-layered ones. You're aware it's a dream and in one layer only to wake into the next one. Another user admitted, I've experienced this a couple times and I can say it's scary at the time. But there's apparently other people that they'll almost hallucinate while they're doing it because they are, like they said, it's kind of a layered dream.
And that's where they get terrified.
Right.
And it's never a positive hallucination.
Yeah.
Right, you know what I mean? It's never like, oh, man, Tinkerbell came in and gave me a mouth hug. You know, it's always right. like a demon was sitting on my chest.
Exactly.
And you're like, yeah, it kind of sucks, dude.
And they couldn't do anything. Like, you can't
move.
You can't say anything. You can't move at all. How do you eventually get yourself to move again, Miles? Do you just, like, blink really hard? Or, like, how?
You, all of a sudden, your body just kind of reacts to your brain finally. When you've been telling it, like, move your arm, and nothing's happening. Then all the next thing you know, finally it moves. You're like, oh, thank God.
Oh, my God. That's terrifying. Speaking of which, these are the 10 common things that scare the living daylights out of people. At number 8, getting touched by something in the water.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Yeah, man.
And I don't care if you're wading along the beach or if you're out there in the deep water, you feel something wriggle past your toes, you're done.
I was in Mexico, actually. Very choppy beach. And I felt something ricochet into my shin. And, I mean, I basically jumped out of the water. You know, I'm still in the water. And I'm freaking out. And do you know what it was?
What was it?
Somebody's baseball cap.
Oh!
Obviously, it had fallen off of their head. Just gotten soaked, so it was kind of underwater. But
right.
when the waves came in, I felt this thing hit. And it was like, oh my God! It's a shark!
You end up kind of like a cat that you've snuck up on.
It is amazing how far you jump.
Oh, yeah.
Your adrenaline rush, you know what I mean? You're like ready for a fight. And I'm like, it's a baseball hat, dude. Calm down.
I mean, yeah, I remember being a teenager swimming in the Atlantic Ocean at the beach. And I'm on a boogie board, so it's at least like up to my neck.
Yeah.
And kick something in the water. Yep. I got out of that water. I was like, I'm not getting back in today.
I don't know what it was.
I mean, it could have been anything. It could have just been a fish, but same thing. I was convinced it was a shark.
Yes.
That's where your brain goes.
Why do we always go to the worst case? Is that just
survival instinct?
Right.
Because if you assume, I'm sure it's nothing, right? Those are the people that, hey, man, did you hear something growling in that cave? I'll go look. People that don't have to survive, like, and that's the last time we saw Fred.
White people.
Right. House is haunted. Let's go check it out.
Let's go see. Let's go make sure it's nothing. Jeez. Number 7, yet again, we get a little dark. Something happening to their kids, which I've never been a father, but I have. That's just universal, you know.
Oh, yeah. It never goes away.
Well, right.
The worry never goes away. And nothing has happened.
It's just.
Nothing, but you know how the world is.
Right.
You know what I mean? So it's not always like being kidnapped or anything like that. It can be much smaller scale stuff, but...
Is it a lack of faith in your kids, too, to make the right decisions?
No. Well, it depends. It depends. That's very situational,
sure.
I would say, you know, depending what it is. But And it's like we said with the internet. It's not the world. The world is what it is, but decisions that people choose to make, or, you know, now that everyone's lost their mind about everything, you know, right. You get shot because you didn't put a biscuit in a bag, you know what I'm saying? So, like, when the world gets to that point, that's when you worry about it.
Sure.
You know, I'm not worried about them getting kidnapped and all that kind of things. I'm pretty sure they'd both be returned with an apology, you know, but...
and $500 cash.
Hey, man.
But, I feel it, man. I'm sorry.
I'm so sorry I did this. But it's just all the other stuff, just the way people are.
Sure.
You know, that's all.
Number six, they go introductions. Quote, let's go around the room and introduce ourselves.
It doesn't bother me.
Yeah, I'm never a fan of that because I never know how long or short to go.
Especially if you have to go first.
Right. And there's always that person that just has the perfect little speech that's, you know, well, I went to school at this, that, and the other thing, and I got my degree in this, and then I found this job over here, and then I've been working there for umpteen amount of years, and then I moved over here and started my own practice, and hi, I work in radio.
There's a guy, his name is Brady Siebold, right?
Okay.
And it's one of the best names you can have. He's a sports broadcaster.
Right.
So he and I, we started this class together. This had to be 24 years ago. And we were doing this thing where each person had to say something about themselves. And I always remember this. He did not say this to the class, but we did not know each other at the time. He just leans to my ear and he goes, my name is Brady and I like to F. And we could not stop giggling. So we were instant friends after that, man. We could not stop giggling.
My name's Mike and I hit dingers.
Right.
Yeah. I think it depends, like you said, it depends on where you are and what the...
Sure.
What you're going to talk about.
Right.
But some people just hate talking in front of other people. So they're scared to death.
Yeah, that's fair. Number five of the 10 common things that scare the living daylights out of people. The worst four words that anybody can ever hear in a relationship that they're happy with.
We need to talk.
Correct.
Oh, yeah.
We need to talk. This one actually.
I thought you said can't find the condom.
Oh, no. I think it broke.
That's followed by we need to talk.
But this one actually expands beyond just a standard relationship. It says my mother, when she texts me, call me without any context. My dad will do that all the time.
I hate that.
Call me when you get a chance.
It's like,
okay. Right. Is everything all right? Do you know where I put this thing?
Yeah, I know. Just like, Jesus
God
Christ.
It, man. If I text somebody, like, I try to be very careful and be like, nothing. Like, even if I,
not
let's
important.
Say I call him Thrill, he doesn't answer, and it's a Saturday afternoon. I'll probably follow up with nothing important, just calling to say hi.
Right. Right.
Yep.
Just call.
You know.
One of my worst experiences, my wife picked me up from work. We are on I-5. We get a text from my daughter that says, help me.
Oh!
We are in traffic because that's how I-5 is. And so I'm freaking the hell out. I'm screaming out the window, like, either get the F on the shoulder, but we're about to start driving.
You bet.
Well, they just started light rail construction, so you couldn't even take the normal exit to get to my house. My wife basically drops me off the corner. I'm a smoker. I did a full sprint to our goddamn house. My wife, she comes screaming up the driveway behind me. We come flying into the house, and my daughter, we're like, what is wrong? Because she wouldn't answer the phone, right? I'm trying to call her house back.
Yeah.
And it is, I just cannot explain the feeling.
Sure.
She wanted to help opening Oreos.
How many of those Oreos got thrown across the room?
Just I her just neck. Stood there for like 20 seconds staring at her like, I am so glad you're okay, but are you effing kidding me? Like, and I said, look, when you say something like help me, try to be a little more specific. Also, if you text help me and I call your ass,
answer
the goddamn phone. I mean, my hands were shaking for like 15 minutes.
And she won't get what that did to you. And she won't understand until like 15 years from now.
Absolutely.
Oh, God. Number four, we probably heard it here recently, the emergency alert system sound.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. It gives people a little anxiety, which I've never been that guy. I've never been
scared
of it.
I'm always just like, what's going on? It finally went off.
Right.
I just assume it's a test because, like I said, they didn't play it on 9/11. So I'm like, I don't know what needs to happen in this country.
Apparently, inclement weather in Everett.
Okay, really?
We had a plane coming at the direction of D.C. and Baltimore.
Yeah.
That was the plane that got taken down in Pennsylvania, right?
Okay.
And they're tracking this. They're telling us it's happening.
Yeah.
They're saying there's one more plane.
Real time.
Yeah. And you see the route. He makes a U-turn and doubles back down. And he's coming over Pittsburgh. And now he's coming right towards us. And just sitting there, got the manual open. Think you're almost on the button.
You want us to play this?
I'm signed into this log. This is the first time I'm ever going to have to do this. Oh, crap, the Pentagon just got hit. Not a damn thing. That's perfectly normal.
Yeah, so I was like, well, I don't even know why we're testing.
Yes. Goodness gracious.
What are we waiting for to happen?
Have you guys heard the EAS sounds from around the world? Like in different countries?
No.
They get spooky.
Oh, really?
Like, yeah, over in, like, Korea, I think. Like, South Korea has a really scary one. Japan has a weird one. One thing
that we definitely noticed in Germany, and I mentioned this. I was like, you know, when the police come by here, or when the sirens are going, it is get the F out of the way siren.
Yeah.
There's no, like, you need to move. There's no, like, the fire trucks downtown. They go, like, are you in a hurry? Should I be in a hurry? We don't know what that means. You sound like you're trying to lull me to sleep instead of get the F out of the way. Like, right. Have some urgency if you need to get someplace to put out a fire. So I'm like,
number three, teenagers. Okay. I don't know why teenagers are scary. Maybe they just got too much confidence and all the confidence,
but none of the smarts.
Immunity in the world, too. You know, they go and break something, like, who's on the rap for that?
It's like, look, they're not up to no good, but more than likely, when I was up to my worst, I was in my teen years.
That's right.
Right? So, I mean, that's all. We had all these stupid things, like, you know, what was it, run up and try to knock someone out in one punch? Perfect.
Oh,
like,
God, yeah.
This was not 40-year-old men running around doing it. I don't think there's any reason to be scared of them, but...
They're unpredictable, man. Like,
most of the carjackings are, you know, it's teens. Right. It might be late teens, but, like, all that kind of crap.
I was going to say, the other problem, too, a 16-year-old kid talking ass to you. You say something bad. Right. And then you'd be like, you didn't hear me. I'm 16. Like, all right.
Fair.
Okay. What if I take this trash can lid and it hits you?
That's right. Yeah. Number two, I've been scared of this one myself. Becoming schizophrenic or developing Alzheimer's disease.
Alzheimer's, maybe. Schizophrenic, yeah. Man. I mean, like, that's, you know, people succumb to Alzheimer's. You hear that kind of on the regular.
Yep.
But I've heard of people either discovering the schizophrenia, but it doesn't seem like that's really attached to you continuing to live.
Sure.
Where Alzheimer's seems like, look, it's the potential is there.
But then the number one common thing that scares the living daylights out of people. You're not far off, Mr. Hill. It's bugs.
All right.
Just standard bugs.
Yeah. I like that that's the number one. We start with, oh my God, abandonment. But bugs are what really get to.
Number one. Yeah. Doggone bugs, man. A woman in Florida was arrested for hitting her ex with a poor choice of weapon, Miles.
What was the poor choice of weapon?
Tell you all about it at 5:50.
Thank you, sir. Headlines are coming at 5:50. In the meantime, let's get a contestant on the line for Profile This at 206-803-ROCK.
You diet, you work out, and still there's that one stubborn spot. Hey, it's Jason. I just went after my stubborn fat by doing Cool Sculpting at Terene Dermatology, Minnesota's top Cool Sculpting provider. Dr. Terene is my dermatologist. We froze my fat, and those fat cells are gone for good. FDA approved. No pain, no downtime. Ranked top doctor 8 years in a row. Trust the experts at Terene Dermatology. Call today, 651-633-6883, and say goodbye to stubborn fat.
T-Mobile's network can help keep you connected to all your favorite podcasts when you're out and about. Whether you're an early bird looking to dive into a daily news podcast or a night owl who wants to catch up on the latest reality TV drama, T-Mobile will keep you connected on their strong and reliable network. T-Mobile covers more highway miles with 5G than anyone. So if you need great coverage, especially when you're on the go, check out T-Mobile. Find out more at T-Mobile.com/CY. That's SEEWHY.
Odyssey celebrates Pride by amplifying the voices, music, and conversations of the LGBTQ+ community. Download the free Odyssey app and listen to podcasts celebrating and having conversations about the issues facing LGBTQ+ Americans, like It's Okay to Say Gay, Queer Intentions, and The Bald and the Beautiful with Trixie Mattel and Katia Zamo. To hear music by and for the LGBTQ+ community, plus podcasts and more, go to odyssey.com/pride or download the free Odyssey app. That's AUDACY.
Inside School of Washington is open to all Washington State residents, grades K through 12. We have a personalized approach to education. Whether it's college credits with dual enrollment, career readiness, or credit recovery, we will accommodate your family's needs. The 23-24 school year enrollment is open now. Go to k12.com/ISWA. That's k12.com/ISWA to find out more. We've been around for over 12 years, doing online schooling successfully. No tuition fee and a high success rate. The support you and your student need. k12.com/ISWA.
Dealing with an accident and injury claim can be overwhelming. Let Phillips Law Firm fight for you. We understand the pain and suffering, and we're here to guide you through. Call 1-800-JUSTICE today for a free case review or visit justiceforyou.com and let Phillips Law Firm help you on the road to recovery.
Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance, too, with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance, and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at progressive.com to join the over 29 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state.
Hey, it's Mike Hawk. Join me every Thursday at 1 p.m. exclusively on the Odyssey app as we go live with Odyssey. Join in on the action as we cover interesting facts, top 10 lists, and some fun new games. Follow the Men's Room page on the Odyssey app and join in all the fun Thursday afternoons at 1.
Hard to be made, it's drinking time.
Somebody out there deserves to be recognized. And the Men's Room knows just who it is. So to you, we say, bottoms up, sailor. You're the toast of our shot of the day.
Drink time it is, and as usual, we head to the drink desk and Steve will throw hell to find out who we're toasting.
Yes, indeed. And today we toast Mr. Joshua Richardson of Volusia County, Florida. Well, last Friday, Joshua was one of multiple motorcyclists that were speeding, popping wheelings, doing all that stuff down the local streets. Well, police, obviously, they're not fond of this kind of thing, so they attempted to pull them over, but the group ignored the police request, and they decided to speed off, leading cops on a high-speed chase. Well, the bikes, they started weaving in and out of traffic, which naturally makes it more difficult for the cops to pursue, and when approaching a red light, the group ignored it, and they just kept going. That's when Joshua specifically, he was the back of the pack, looked over his shoulder, looked right at the cops, flipped in the bird, turned around, and was promptly T-boned by a truck.
Jesus.
Oh, yeah. Took his ass out. Now, he did survive the arrest, okay? So he flips the cops off, turns back around, truck nails his ass, which is why you don't run red lights. But the funny thing about it was they go up to arrest him, they handcuffed him, and now he's pleading with the cops going, hey, man, I'm really hurt. The cops are like, we know because you got hit by a truck. Joshua goes, do you think this is funny? The cops said, no, we don't think it's funny. We think we're stupid. Joshua's response to that, what was I supposed to do? We're being chased by cops. And the cops said, pull over and find out why we're chasing him. I mean, they're just like, Jesus Christ, man, this guy doesn't even understand. But yeah, flipped the cops off, turned around, instantly taken out.
Damn.
So we poured this, I almost toasted Carl on that one. So we pour this booze and we drink this booze because we think it's yummy.
Yummy!
So over the tongue and down the throat to party in our tummies.
Down the hola, bitona!
The Men's Room presents Profile This.
And Steve Throw Hill, could you please tell everyone how Profile This is played?
I sure can, Miles. It's a simple game where we share with you a real life news story, something that happened right here on planet Earth. And as you listen to the story, based on the stereotypes you believe to be true of people and the decisions that people make, we'll ask you what it is you think makes the story a story. Now, our phone lines just took an S about 2 minutes ago, so you guys will be playing Profile This. What category would you like to add? We have the wonderful world of drugs. We have Bite Me. In other words, what did someone find in the food? Interior decorating, where you guess the foreign object that ended up on the inside of someone. And, of course, Hit Me With Your Best Shot, where you guess the unconventional weapon that someone used as a weapon.
Hit me!
It's actually the perfect category for you today because I know the way both you and Miles think. So let's go to Florida, where a retiree hurled something and racial slurs at a Burger King employee in a rage over the thickness of a tomato on her sandwich.
I just like the way you said that. And racial slurs.
And, well, so she hurled something and racial slurs at the Burger King employee because the thickness of a frickin' tomato. Judith Black, 78 years old, she entered a no contest plea to the misdemeanor charge. She was sentenced to 12 months probation, fined $785, and ordered to attend anger management classes, which is 78 is worth it. I don't say she's set in her ways.
Yeah.
Anyway, the judge also barred her from returning to the Burger King where the battery occurred and ordered her to have no contact with the worker she attacked. So the 78-year-old racist was initially charged with an enhanced felony battery count due to her use of racist language during the incident. Remember this, kids. If you just want a regular charge, keep your mouth shut and throw punches. And why'd you open your mouth? You make it worse. So her outburst stemmed from her dismay about the thickness of the tomato on her sandwich. She brought a complaint to the restaurant's front counter where she began yelling at Tapresha Brown, the 23-year-old Burger King employee. Now, Brown told cops that she advised Black that unless she calmed down about the tomato issue, it would not be addressed. When Brown turned her back, Black threw something at her, striking the worker below the neck. Well, Black, who was with her husband, then told the worker, "Shut up, you black bitch," and then spewed a series of racial slurs. Mm. When police later questioned Black at her residence, she confessed to the ballistic behavior, saying that she was angry at the victim for not fixing the issue. Well, cops reported that the lady also admitted to calling the worker a stupid black bitch, a black N-bomb, and F-U black N-bombs. The ironically named Black's tomato tantrum was recorded by restaurant surveillance cameras, etc. So the question is, what did this racist fool decide to use as a weapon? Was it her milkshake, a Whopper, her onion rings, or a Royal Crispy Chicken Sandwich? So milkshake, Whopper, onion rings, or Royal Crispy Chicken Sandwich. One of those met the neck of the Burger King employee.
Well, you'd think that she maybe would have handed the sandwich over at first if she was complaining about it, but you might have had a
fixed the separate tomato.
Yeah. I'm going to go milkshake, too. Milkshake to the back of the neck.
I just can't decide Whopper or chicken sandwich, but...
Royal Crispy chicken sandwich.
Yeah, yeah. Single, double, triple. Whopper.
You want Whopper?
Okay. Yeah. I mean, that song's in my head.
What was this BK employee hit with? A milkshake, a Whopper, onion rings, or the Royal Crispy chicken sandwich? We'll find out next.
That was a tease. Walk the dogs, school drop-off, meetings from 10 to 3, take kids to soccer, then no time left for a jog.
When everyone else is relying on you, it's easy to put your needs last. BetterHelp connects you with a licensed therapist online, so you can show up for yourself the way you do for others. Visit BetterHelp.com/positive to get 10% off your first month. That's BetterHelp.com/positive.
99.9 KISW. We return to the men's room with Miles and Thrill.
Categories, hit me with your best shots on Profile This, where someone uses a unconventional object to attack someone. Got a Florida retiree. She hurled something along with racial slurs at an employee of Burger King because the tomato on her sandwich was cut too thick for her liking.
That's correct, yeah.
Hit the employee on the back of the neck. Question is, what did she hurl? Was it a milkshake, a Whopper, a thing of onion rings, or a Royal Crispy Chicken Sandwich?
Thank you for getting that last one right. Miles, you went with the milkshake.
I went milkshake.
Which I would think would be the, when you're really trying to make an impact.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Ted, you went with the Whopper just
because the Whopper.
Just because the song was in your head.
Whopper.
There you go.
Ah. I rule.
You do rule, Ted. Hit her with a Whopper.
I think it's a big sandwich.
Yeah, it is.
It's a big sandwich.
Now for all TV news all the time, it's time for TV Time with Ted.
And now, because your pathetic life is confined to countless hours in front of a talking box, the Men's Room presents TV Time with Ted.
I'm still just laughing. I mean, obviously, there's never a correct or okay time to go on a racial tirade, but like, over a tomato!
Not the thickness of the cut.
Oh, all right. We got Bill Maher.
That's where we're at, man.
SNL Weekend Update.
Okay.
The Jimmys.
Alan Kimmel.
Seth Meyers. Or Ted Smith.
Is it Ted or is it Larry?
That's right, throw the title. These guys have teams of talented writers, help them come up with their monologues each and every night. It is up to you to determine, is this an actual late night joke and from whom, or could it be a The Ted Smith original?
As this year's awards season gets underway, there's growing movement to get rid of the gendered categories of best actor and best actress, and instead call them best actor and best actor who got paid less.
SNL.
Fallon.
That's SNL.
As this year's awards season gets underway, there's growing movement to get rid of the gendered categories of best actor and best actress and instead call them best actor and best actor who got paid less.
In entertainment news, actor Matthew McConaughey was on a flight last week from Austin to Germany. They had to make an emergency landing after the flight hit an air pocket over Tennessee and experienced severe turbulence. When asked about the flight, McConaughey said the flight was not all right, all right, all right.
Me, Ted Smith.
Yeah, Ted Smith.
Yeah, that's fine. I mean, I liked it.
Entertainment news.
Yeah. Researchers just discovered that winemaking began 11,000 years ago. And now Bravo has announced a new show,
The Real Housewives of Macedonia.
Fallon.
Researchers just discovered that winemaking began 11,000 years ago. Yep. To find out more, tune into the new Bravo show, The Real Housewives of Mesopotamia.
Scientists found a rare Jurassic insect at a Walmart in Arkansas. It's so old that it's already been hired as a greeter.
Weekend update.
Yeah, weekend update.
Fallon.
Get this, I heard that a scientist found a super rare Jurassic era insect at a Walmart in Arkansas. Yeah, I mean, it's ancient, and good news, it was immediately hired as a greeter.
The U.S. Energy Department concluded that COVID likely originated from a Wuhan laboratory, Wuhan laboratory leak, not a wet market. So I gave up eating bats for nothing?
I'm going to stick with the weekend update.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was update.
The U.S. Energy Department concluded that COVID likely originated from a Wuhan laboratory leak and not a wet market. So I gave up eating bats for nothing?
We'll say SNL was pretty funny this week. There was a couple things on weekend, and usually weekend update to me is the highlight. I thought weekend update was a little weaker than normal, but man, Travis Kelce was super funny.
He did a great job.
He was in a lot of skits, and some of the skits were just awesome. The, I can't think of his name. The Asian dude that's pretty funny.
Bowen Yang.
I was going to call him Yoan Bang. I was screwing up the letters. He did a very good skit where he's a gay man, and he's talking about having brunch with his girls and all the drama, and it's like, so I tried a new thing. Straight white friend. Or straight white, or Jesus, straight male friend. Oh, I said white.
Buzzwords.
I know. But it was pretty good. At the end of it, you know, it ends up with, like, you could find these guys everywhere except therapy. But it's like, yeah. Well, because he's just like, it's like, yeah, he doesn't even bother me with drama. Sometimes you got, like, you never even know. And it's like, yeah, just, I don't know, my dad died last week. And he's like, what? And then he's like, yeah, you want to go get some wings? And then when they go get wings, he's like, sorry for being such a peed about my dad dying.
Right.
Yeah. And what was it like? The only thing he really gets upset about is they're eating wings. And he goes, I'm faster than you. And Kelsey's like, what? Dude, I will go outside and race you right now.
Right.
Which I do think people are better about mental health and stuff.
Sure.
But generally, yeah, that's kind of the fun with hanging out with the fellas. Like, yeah, I don't know. We'll watch some sports, play some music. Yeah.
This is called escapism for me.
Yeah, just kind of BSing. But the skits were very good. His brother showed up. He was in the audience for a couple of them. I was like, man, that, I feel like that's the first episode I've seen all season where, you know, there's always, again, and I say this, SNL's going to have a lot of bad skits. It's a live show that's on all the time.
Sure.
But this one, I just thought they knocked it out of the park with a bunch of them.
Well, most of the time they've got somebody who's involved in a movie coming out or a new television show, or they got honored at an award ceremony, they won something, but they're kind of professionals at doing theater. You got a guy that's one of the best tight ends in the league who doesn't really do that for a living. So if he can go on that show with a week preparation and do such a great job, because that's not in the element. And if you can do that, that's impressive.
And that's what I'm saying. He was in a lot of skits. That American Girl doll skit, like, you kind of forget it's Jason Kelce for a minute. Like, that's how good he was.
That's cool. I got to watch that.
Yeah. Travis. One of them.
Yes.
I think I called him Jason Kelce all morning, all day, haven't I?
Yes.
It's Travis. Jason, his brother was there.
We all know Jason's the funny one.
So I guess sometimes you have subtitles on TV. Words will disappear because it's before you can finish them, right? Because the shows are very wordy.
Sure.
So I have a list here about the TV's wordiest shows. They have the top 10. Now, I won't lie to you. Like, most of them are going to be comedies.
Okay.
Right? So Parks and Recs came in at number 10.
All right.
Then you had Big Mouth.
Okay.
Then South Park. Then Bob's Burgers. So you're kind of sensing a theme here, right? Which makes sense, because comedy moves.
Yeah, they boom, 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 boom. Yeah.
Right. Suits was 6 on the list. 5 was Central Park. I don't even know that show.
I don't know
that
one either.
4 was Modern Family.
Okay.
3rd on the list was Gilmore Girls. Number 2 was Brooklyn Nine-Nine. What do you think was the wordiest show ever? It's a comedy.
My guess is it's got to be Big Bang Theory.
All right.
Maybe The Office.
It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia.
Ah, that. Okay.
All right.
Yep.
And if you're a fan of that show and you watch it, there's a lot of action going on in that show. Like, they're chatting. Mm-hmm. the whole time.
There. That was one of the first things I said about watching The Mandalorian. It was almost like an old Italian spaghetti western based on just the first season. There wasn't a ton of dialogue.
Mm-hmm. It really wasn't.
It was just basically the scenes were kind of dictating, you know, the story, and that was kind of a cool element too. But it was an awful quiet show, even though it was cool.
I will say another one that's really wordy. It's on Hulu. Ryan Castle's a big fan of it. Letterkenny. I had to start watching that with the subtitles on just because it was so funny and so quick. It was just this rapid fire joke after joke after joke. I'd be laughing my ass off, and I'd miss two or three jokes that are right there in the middle. To where I had to watch it with subtitles so I could at least see the delivery of the jokes that were coming, and it got even funnier.
Plus, it's Canadian.
Yeah.
So sometimes there's just slang and stuff, like, you're just not going to pick up. I mean, it's not a huge difference, Canada, but, like, yeah, there's definitely slang terms that we don't use.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I told you, I love comedies from all over the world, but the Irish one I watched that one, Hardy Bucks. I had to watch that. I watched that series three or four times. But the first, like, two, I had to have subtitles on. Because I didn't understand the slang, and I couldn't. Their brogues were so thick, they were pretty tough to get. Let's see. Chris Rock also had his comedy special come out Saturday night. It was all right.
Okay. Yeah, I didn't watch it.
All right. But. Yeah. I mean, I don't know. Maybe it's just been years since I've seen a Chris Rock special. I was kind of, a little more aggressive during the middle part. And, like, I don't know, like, it's not my place to say. I thought there were certain words he wasn't using anymore. They're all back.
Oh, yeah. I heard bits and pieces.
Yeah, the Will Smith stuff, though, at the end was very good. And he just made some valid points about Will Smith, just talking about their size difference and this and that. And he's like, what am I supposed to do? But also, I thought he made a good point, right? Because the whole special is about... what's it like judgment in the wrong place, right? Selective outrage. That was the name of the special.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So also, I think he made a good point with Will Smith, though, too, where he was like, selective outrage, and then he chose to smack me, a guy he knows I can beat up. Which, that one resonated with me the most, right? There's certain places, and like, look, some people are just going to be physically bigger and this and that, and I've seen it with my own eyes. It's like, dude, you're just picking on that dude in the bar because you can. Right,
and
as opposed
then,
to being
because your wife asked you to.
As right, as opposed to being like a tough guy that's going to stand up to another like tough guy or whatever like that. I mean, look, at the end of the day, that's why they have weight classes when it comes to professional boxing and fight any combat sport. Like you try to keep people even. Sure. So I thought that was a very good point. Frankly, his ending note. Not my place to say that joke. But I mean,
he played Ali.
He said that. He goes, look, he played Ali. I played Pookie in New Jack City. You know, there was, don't get me wrong, there were some good lines. I mean, I was laughing. I just, it wasn't the best comedy special I've seen in a while.
I liked how all the headlines talked about how, you know, man, he went for the jugular against Will Smith and Jade. It's like, wasn't that kind of the whole thing that everybody was talking about? Like, this is where I'm going to finally address it.
Right. Well, he makes a good point, too. He's like, look, I was a massive fan of Will's.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know, which is, you know, like, yeah. Like, it's not like they didn't know each other. It's not like they didn't run in some of the same circles. And, like, I don't know a lot. Like, until that slap happened, like, the worst thing you'd hear about Will Smith is some people thought he was corny.
Right.
Yeah. Exactly.
You know what I mean?
Weird.
But I feel like it seemed like everybody in Hollywood liked him. I imagine a lot of people were probably cheering for him and stuff.
And Jada Pinkett Smith, a few years back, she brought up the fact that Chris Rock should not host the Oscars anymore. And this was in the middle of the diversity situation with the Oscars based on who won the previous year and everything else and the fact that there was a lack of that. Well, she said, specifically, Chris Rock should not do this. And one of the reasons was he was kind of shunned for Emancipation, maybe? I cannot remember the name of the movie that he was that year that he had put out. But he deserved a nomination for an Academy Award. But she said this after that. So it was like, it just seemed a little like the timing, like, hey, man, this is my gig.
There's definitely more personal stuff there between him and Jada than just that. Also, though, nice weekend of sports in town.
Oh, man.
Sounders look good Saturday night.
Yep.
I saw your Sea Dragons won, and then
it was great Saturday night.
Last night, I saw the Kraken get a nice win in overtime.
Yeah, over the Stanley Cup champions.
Yeah, so that was pretty good. Yeah, and look, the Avalanche are a tough team and stuff.
Yes,
they were really grinding for some of those goals. And also, shout out to the Kraken. getting me even to be more of a puck guy.
Yeah.
I was watching hockey last night, and like somebody out, like, you know what it was? They were trying to clear. Colorado was trying to clear their zone. Mm-hmm. And somebody just threw their like stick out to stop the puck, and I'm like, good stick. Which I don't even know if that's a thing. Maybe I should have yelled.
It is now.
It's an active stick.
Yeah.
That's what you need to have.
Hey, congrats to the Wazoo ladies, man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They won the Pac-12 for the first time in their basketball history.
Are we still calling it Pac-12? I mean, UCLA, and see your
we're back to the Pac-10.
As a back to 10.
Right. Hey, look, we still call it the Big Ten. There's like 20 teams in there.
Called the Pack.
Right. Just call it the Pack is
leaders
back.
Of the Pack.
There you go.
Thank you, Tim. We appreciate it. You are listening to The Men's Room.
What you watch depends on what kind of mood you're in. Sometimes you're craving comedies like Friends or South Park, and sometimes you're more into dramas like HBO's Succession and House of the Dragon. There's also cooking shows like Chopped and Beat Bobby Flay, and even movies like The Lord of the Rings and Shazam! Fury of the Gods. Well, Max is the streaming destination that has the best of entertainment for whatever mood you're in, anytime. And plans start at as little as $9.99 a month. Max, the one to watch. Subscription required. Visit max.com.
The Men's Room returns with Miles and Thrill. Now, let's see what's happening in the real world.
All right, here we go. Daytona Beach man hears a knock at his door, opens it, and an alligator bites his leg. Meanwhile, a Massachusetts town is looking to open a store where you can buy weed and a lap dance from Meg. Unruly passenger refuses to sit down, ignores crew's instructions, and pees on man in seat 15G. Wedding venue owner waves his gun at the couple's reception for all to see. And a drunk guy steals a fire truck, crashes it, and sets a house on fire with a fire truck. It is time for headlines.
Now, it's time to hit the head. Lines. Here's my car.
All right, our top story. We go to the bastion of good behavior known as Florida, where a woman was arrested for assaulting her ex. She works in a local strip club and had recently broken off a six-month relationship with one of the security guards that worked there. Their breakup was amicable, right up until she caught him at work going over to talk to another one of their coworkers. How dare he? In a fit of rage, the woman found the nearest thing that she could find to throw at him. A nice big wad of cash that she launched right in the back of his head. On top of that, she did some damage to his phone, landing her both assault and criminal mischief charges. Good work.
You threw cash.
For real.
I mean, you know, if you're going to throw something, it would not be my money.
No. He made you like that something mad. Less
I might pull my cash out of my wallet and throw my wallet, but I'd be like, hang on one second.
You know what I do? I try to barehand it and just put it right in my pocket.
Yeah, grab it
you
and leave.
You bet. Yeah, if she wasn't hitting me in the back of the head, you bet I would have caught that thing. In other news, staying in Florida for a situation that got way too out of control. The story takes place at a local wedding venue where a couple exchanged vows and began their life journey together. As can be expected, following a wedding ceremony, a reception commenced and the party began to dance the night away. Goodness. But the merriment came to an abrupt end when the owner of the venue had finally had enough. The story says that he had already gotten into an altercation with the party due to a time dispute, but he felt the most appropriate action to get the group to vacate the premises was to start waving a gun and shouting for the party to leave.
Well, I mean, it works.
It is effective.
It is very, very effective and efficient.
Nobody was injured in the incident and two arrests were made. I have no idea what could possibly... Obviously, what happened is he went to somebody and says, you guys need to get out of here.
Mm-hmm.
My guess is they said, we paid for the venue.
Sure.
So we're going to stay here for the agreed upon time. And then I think after that, he had no ground to stand on, so he grabs a gun. This is all my opinion.
Yeah, I'd say he handled it well, but... For what he was hoping to accomplish, he achieved it.
Right.
Dreams of a Dumbass. That should be a book.
If you're not good at running a venue, don't run a venue.
Don't run a venue.
That's it.
Pretty simple.
Right. If you're double booked, go to them and say, I double booked this. I will refund you money that you've paid to be here.
People make the world infinitely more complicated than it needs to be. A lot of times I say, do you know why I do not work as a Mandarin translator at the UN? I do not speak Mandarin.
What?
It is that simple. Therefore, this is not a job that I would even apply for.
Other than that, you're perfectly qualified.
Perfectly qualified.
Like, I would hire you as a Mandarin translator if only you spoke Mandarin.
If I do that one thing, you will hire me.
That's right.
All right,
that's
but now...
all I need, man.
You have to hope I'm telling you the truth.
That's bad.
See, that's the beauty of a translator, right? Because maybe the person speaking Mandarin is like...
Oh, my God.
I think Mike is a wonderful addition to our company. We cannot wait to give him a program. Like, brother, you're on your last legs here. They're tired of it. You don't know. That's why you hire me. I would lie my ass off.
I want to write that skit of you just being an interpreter, but you don't have the first damn
no idea
what they're saying. Oh, man, he just called you a bitch.
I'm going to try to read their facial expressions and body language. Put it into context.
I'm really good at context reading.
I don't know what they're saying, you see, but I got a vibe.
He's waving his hands a lot. He's not happy with you.
He's not happy with you at all.
You see the furrowed brow? He's not happy.
I think he just says something about your mom. I don't know.
We go to Long Island, where one man had a heck of a night. Surveillance footage from the local fire department shows the man drunkenly walking into the firehouse and jumping into one of their pickup trucks, driving it away while crashing through a pair of closed doors.
Good idea.
His joyride continues for a short time before he crashes the truck into a utility pole, which then sparked a house fire nearby. Police arrived on the scene and gave him a field sobriety test, which he failed with flying colors, and he was arrested.
I know legally you have to give the field sobriety test, but sometimes, like, aren't you just wasting time?
Right.
Really, we're going to spend money. Does this cost us money to administer this test?
This poll wasn't put here when I first started driving. This is stupid.
To Daytona Beach, where a man was ambushed right at his front door. Late at night, he heard a noise at his door and went to investigate, thinking it was somebody there looking for his son. But when he opened the door, he was greeted by a terrifying, nearly 8-foot-long alligator.
That's incredible.
Yeah. The reptile wasted no time lashing out at the homeowner, getting a good bite in on his leg. The man retreated back into his home and called authorities, who showed up and were able to wrangle the beast.
Why did he think it was someone looking? I mean, did the alligator say, "Hey, is Billy home?"
Well, it was like 10 to 10 at night.
Right.
His kid's probably of an age where his buddies will show up at any hour of the night. Like, "Hey, is Jacob home?" You know. Being that it's mating season for the animals, they're expected to do a little bit more exploration and be a little on the testy side.
If I live in Florida, get a Ring camera.
Yes.
I don't think it matters. Steve and I saw a video today of an alligator going through a steel, like a wrought iron fence, and just splitting it across, splitting it, and walking right through it.
But not violently. Yeah. Like, it literally just
waddled through it. Yeah. That's it for your headlines. With that, Mike Hawk is out.
Thank you, sir. Lovely. Taryn Daly's up next. We'll see you tomorrow for Ryan Castle and the return of Sit and Spin Now.
Yes, indeed. It's all true. But in the meantime, well, we be all about this bitch for 180 seconds or so. So until then, please, do what you do best. And for Aletha's sake, stay beautiful.
The Men's Room has been taped before a live studio audience. Wardrobe and makeup provided by Mantastic Limited. This has been a presentation of the Men's Room Radio Network.
Oh, man!
A Double Flush production.
Love the skin you're in with Hand and Stone Massage and Facial Spa's facial services. Enjoy the tranquility and deep relaxation while giving your skin a rejuvenating glow. All facials are tailored to your individual needs using the highest quality ingredients designed to give you healthy, radiant, and younger looking skin. Visit any one of their 8 Seattle Hand and Stone Massage and Facial Spa locations or book online at handandstone.com. Restrictions apply. See spa for details.
You diet, you work out, and still there's that one stubborn spot. Hey, it's Jason. I just went after my stubborn fat by doing Cool Sculpting at Terene Dermatology, Minnesota's top Cool Sculpting provider. Dr. Terene is my dermatologist. We froze my fat, and those fat cells are gone for good. FDA approved. No pain, no downtime. Ranked top doctor 8 years in a row. Trust the experts at Terene Dermatology. Call today, 651-633-6883, and say goodbye to stubborn fat.
T-Mobile's network can help keep you connected to all your favorite podcasts when you're out and about. Whether you're an early bird looking to dive into a daily news podcast or a night owl who wants to catch up on the latest reality TV drama, T-Mobile will keep you connected on their strong and reliable network. T-Mobile covers more highway miles with 5G than anyone. So if you need great coverage, especially when you're on the go, check out T-Mobile. Find out more at T-Mobile.com/CY. That's SEEWHY.
If you're a contractor, it's now easier for you to do business with the Department of Labor and Industries. Go to lni.wa.gov/skip the line and make an appointment with us ahead of time. No waiting around, no wasted time away from your job site. You get in, get out, and get on your way. easy. So contractors, just go to lni.wa.gov/skip the line to make an appointment and get back to doing what you do best.